So this topic is near and dear to my heart, developmental education. And so this is, we're so pleased to have being able to host this very important conversation at Lane. So we're really glad you're here. Thank you very much for our presenters, some of the most experienced nationally individuals around developmental ed here for this conversation today. So we're very pleased that they joined us also. And I also would like to just say a couple things about this building. This is a LEED Platinum building. We moved into it, our academic programs in January. And so we're still getting used to it. We're still trying to figure out some of the things about this building because it is so energy efficient. So we would encourage you, if you get time, to go ahead and walk around. You can go all the way up to the top floor and see the different programs. It's a beautiful building. We're so blessed and pleased to be here. In addition to that, you'll notice that around, we're kind of wrapped around another building. That's our new housing facility, and we opened that actually last fall. And we're slowly but very enthusiastically filling it with a lot of international students, actually. So it's very, very cool to have this complex here. We're very pleased to be in the heart of Eugene. So again, thank you for coming. Enjoy your day. It's an important conversation, and welcome to Lane.
I'm Kathy Lindsley. I'm the Dean for Academic Learning Skills, which is part of developmental ed at Lane, and also English as a second language and tutoring. And I'm here to tell you the really important stuff, and that is where the bathrooms are. So the bathrooms are on that end of the building, all floors all the way up, and there's another set over here. And for smokers, this is a non-smoking campus. It's non-smoking all the way to the middle of the street. And then on the other side is non-smoking to the library because that's City of Eugene property. So the smoking area you will find is way over at the LTD place. So, yeah, kitty corner, yeah. We'll be serving lunch here out in the hallway, and the coffee and muffins and water are at either side. And the Center for Meaning and Learning is our host at this area, and they also do the conferences that you've probably attended over at the main campus. I'm really glad that you're all here because I was having nightmares that you would all go to the wrong campus, and I'd be sitting down here all by myself. So I'm glad to see you here, and Lane's Academic Learning Skill Department and our math department and tutoring are really glad that we can have this here to work with us together. I've heard a couple of comments that people are chilly, and this is one of the only two spaces in the building that does have air conditioning, and we have turned it down. I was here yesterday afternoon for a meeting, and this building was comfortable all day long, even when it got warm in the afternoon, so I think we're going to be okay. So if you have any questions about the building or about Eugene or anything Lane, please talk to one of us. And my friends from Academic Learning Skills are over here at this table, and they can answer questions too. So thank you very much for coming. And I want to introduce Elizabeth from Community Colleges and Workforce Development to sort of frame the day. So.
Thanks, Kathy. My name's Elizabeth Cox-Brand. I'm the Director of Research and Communications for CCWD. And I would really like to thank Kathy and everybody here at Lane, especially the technology guys. Thank you so much for all of the requests and things that we have. You know that this is being streamed live out on the internet, and we're also archiving this. So when you have some folks back home who wanted to see this, didn't get a chance, we are going to have this on our website so that you can access it. Also, just so you know, we will have all the handouts and things also on the website so that you can access those as well. I was asked to just kind of provide a little context for why are we doing this now? What's been going on in Oregon that may make this something that we'd want to be talking about at this point? And so as I was thinking about it, we all know the research, and I'm not going to go through that because it's a beautiful day and it's sunny, and I'm not going to bum everybody out. But we all know about that. We all know about 40-40-20 and all that's going on, and achievement compacts and everything else. We all know about those things. But there's some really positive things that are happening here in Oregon that's making this the right time to be having this conversation as a kickoff. And it happened through some serendipity that this is all coming together. So I have just a few pieces of how this all happened. So the first one I've heard Katie present a couple of times. I've been honored to have the chance to hear Katie. I heard her once, 2 years ago, I think, at a Complete College America event in Austin, Texas, and was very impressed with what they're doing in California. And then actually she spoke at the Oregon Community Colleges Association conference this past November. So then all of your boards of trustees and your presidents got the chance to hear her and got very excited about what's happening in California. And then we also have something going on in the state called Achieving the Dream. Raise your hand if you're in Achieving the Dream school. Yeah. There's 10 of your community colleges out of the 17 that are Achieving the Dream schools. Lane is one that's in its second year, and then we have 9 others that are in their first year. So if you know anything about Achieving the Dream, they do a lot of focus on developmental education and helping to move students through so that they can reach their goals and to find their journeys. So we were all down at the Dream Institute in Anaheim in February, and a lot of the folks heard about different things that are happening in Texas. There's Statway that's happening in Texas, and we hear a lot of good things about who's doing what with developmental education and everything. And we had an all-Oregon meeting, which was fantastic, because that's the one time that I get the chance to talk to presidents and faculty and staff and vice presidents and IR and everybody all at the same time. And so we talked about it, and I said, you know what, there's 10 of you out of 17. We're getting some great momentum. What are some things that you would like to see us working at a state level with all of this that's happening amongst all of you 10 colleges? And math and math redesign was one of the top things that came up. So that was another piece. And then I happened to be invited to talk at a March 1st developmental education gathering, and Shireen's going, yes, thank you, and Luann and Kathy. And I got to go there and talk with those folks, and the energy that was coming out of that as well of, we need to do something, and this is a great time to be doing this, and what are we going to do? And so we had kind of all of that stuff coming together. I'm also part of a research alliance. It's the Oregon Community College Research Alliance with Education Northwest, and there's a couple of young ladies here who are representing them that'll be talking with us later. And Dan Lang from Blue Mountain's part of that. We have Lisa Reynolds from CCWD is part of that. We have some Department of Education folks, and we have some OUS folks that are part of that. And we're looking at one piece is developmental education, and what is it that we need to do, and how can we make some changes? So everything kind of came together. And I said, well, you know, I'm having these conversations in like 3 or 4 different places. Let's bring everybody to one spot and see what we can do. And the perfect people to do that are Katie and Myra. No pressure. Yeah. So I'm very, very glad that we could work this out and that you could come in. And it's not your finals week and everything. And even though the Dalai Lama's here, thank you so much for picking us over the Dalai Lama. I'm so impressed. We promise to live up to it. So I'm looking forward to a fantastic day, and that this is a kickoff to a lot more bigger, exciting conversations happening here in Oregon. So Katie and Myra, thank you.
Thank you.
Yes. Myra and I were confessing to each other at breakfast that choosing between this event and the Dalai Lama, we would have gone with the Dalai Lama. You know, how many chances will we have to see him? So anyway, thank you for being here.
Reincarnated, you know, that'll be like in a little kid. So it'll be before that person reaches adulthood, we probably won't be here.
Yeah.
So yeah, actually get in to see him. So can everyone hear us? So before we get started, we were supposed to make an announcement about the folks who are at Center Light locations. So if you're one of those people, my understanding is that there is going to be opportunity for you to chat. So there will be things appearing at the bottom of your screen where you can actually enter questions, and we have someone here who's monitoring questions who will put those onto the floor so we can respond to them. Okay?
Okay. So we wanted to start with just a little video, because one of the
our main focus is this thing called acceleration, and what does that really mean, and what, you know, so we have a little video of, we've been working with faculty across the state of California who are implementing accelerated courses in English and math, and we thought we'd start with their voices. So we had a gathering last January, and we went around with the video camera and said, what does acceleration mean to you? And then, you know, you're going to see just a couple of minutes of them answering that question. And hopefully the satellite folks can see it too.
Acceleration means to me that students who otherwise wouldn't will realize education's promise.
Acceleration means to me shortening the path that students have to travel without dumbing down the curriculum.
Acceleration means to me that we respect the intellectual capabilities of our developmental students.
It means to me blowing up the walls and using data to go forward.
Acceleration means to me providing students an experience of rigor at the college level while engaging with relevant material.
Acceleration means to me getting our students excited and letting them know that it's going to be over sooner than later.
Acceleration means to me a breath of fresh air and giving hope to our students.
Acceleration means to me respecting students' capacity to excel and helping them to find and tap into their intrinsic motivation.
Acceleration means to me a whole new way to think about our students.
Acceleration to me means kicking students' asses, but in a gentle, encouraging, positive way.
Acceleration means to me a chance to reinvent myself as a teacher and for students to reinvent themselves as learners.
Acceleration means to me every student having a chance to succeed.
Acceleration means equal opportunity through curricular redesign.
So while we're pulling up the PowerPoint, Katie and I are just going to briefly introduce ourselves. I'm Myra, and I've been teaching at a community college in Northern California for 21 years in the math department there. And I've been working with Katie and the California Acceleration Project for the last several years, and we now have 21 out of our 112 community colleges in California who are embarking on major redesign in mathematics, and most of them are teaching pre-statistics courses for students who are in non-math intensive majors. In lieu of the traditional algebra curriculum.
And I'm Katie, and I'm an English teacher at Chabot College in the Bay Area, and I'm director of the California Acceleration Project, work with Myra, and there's also a reading and writing side of our work where, we just accepted a new cohort of colleges, so I don't know how many total colleges in English now. It's
altogether, it's 40, and some of the colleges have both math and English acceleration happening.
And they're doing different versions of acceleration that often involve integrating reading and writing, or combining two previously separate courses, or increasing the level of challenge. So I'll talk a little bit more about that. But it's very exciting work to be part of. And our work is funded by our state chancellor's office through the Basic Skills Initiative, and it's very grassroots. So we are teachers speaking to teachers about how we've designed our curricula and how we could have better results with students. And each college designs locally what they feel is going to make sense for them within the general principles we're sharing. So this is our project, California Acceleration Project. And we start with the problem that we're trying to address. That's always our starting point in these conversations. This is the bad news that Elizabeth mentioned that I think we're all clear about. But we'll just start with the bad news and then move forward. The more levels of developmental education a student is required to go through, the fewer of them go on to complete that college level English or math course. Are you all clear about that? And some of that is from the Achieving the Dream schools. Some of our clarity as a sort of a field of developmental education comes from studying the Achieving the Dream schools. So the Community College Research Center has done this nationwide study of the Achieving the Dream colleges, and it's a huge data set, 57 colleges in multiple states, 250,000 students. And this is what they found is you know, the lower down a student starts in the developmental sequence, the fewer of them complete that first college-level transferable course in the discipline. So in reading, if they start one level below, 42% complete college English, two levels below, 29%, three or more levels below, 24%.
So in our next slide, we're going to look at this data from the same set of colleges for math. Do you think we're going to see higher percentages or lower percentages? Yeah, they're quite a bit lower. So I actually find this data, even though I'm very familiar with it, shocking every time I look at it. So if you're a math person, what this is saying is that if a student is placing one level below transfer, so they're like in an intermediate algebra course typically around the nation, only 27% of them go on to actually complete a transferable math course. And if students are placing at something like pre-algebra or arithmetic, right, three levels or more below transfer, we're getting a measly 10% of them through actually a completion of a college-level math course. So before we look at other slides, I want to emphasize the measure that we're looking at here, which is the needle that we're going to be using all day today. And the measure is looking at the completion of the gatekeeper course. So we're not looking at success rates for individual courses. We're actually asking for a given cohort of students starting at a given placement level, what percentage of them complete the transferable gatekeeper course in the discipline. Okay.
And the window of this study, and that is we're tending to use, is a three-year window. You give them 3 years, count repeats, and, you know, that sort of thing. Okay. So another, so this, that data is sort of, that's our starting point. That's why we're doing this work, that we as educators don't feel good about those numbers. We don't feel like that's why we're here, that's our purpose in becoming community college teachers, like that doesn't feel good to us. And so that's really driving our work. It's not an efficiency mandate from our state system or performance-based funding or get them through whether or not they learn, none of that. It's that we don't feel good about those results. Those don't feel consistent with why we're here, why we're educators. So we're motivated by that, to try to redesign what we're doing and think differently so that more students can be successful. Another piece of what's driving us is an equity orientation. So this system of the multi-layered remediation is hurting all students, and nobody is faring well if they place far down. But some students are more likely to be placed far down, at least inside our own state, and it'd be interesting to look at this for Oregon. More than half of Black and Latino students place 3 to 4 levels down in the math sequence. And that's the group that inside California, our completion rate for that group is 6% within 3 years complete a transferable math course. So that group that has the terrible results is disproportionately Black and Latino students in California. And so that's just another piece where we don't feel good about that. And we're motivated to change. And in the English sequences, it's less of a percentage of students, but it's still disproportionately, students of color are disproportionately placed 3 and 4 levels below, where they really have a hard time getting anywhere in their education. Okay, so this is our starting point. This is we're going to share the framework that we work with in our thinking about this. And just to sort of walk you through a thought experiment. So when a student starts two levels below in English or math, there are what we call 5 exit points where they fall away. And actually there are 6, because sometimes they get that placement result and just never enroll, right? So we're only tracking here the students who actually did enroll in that first course that they're placed in, and that's the Achieving the Dream data we showed you. So it's actually worse. It's worse than what we showed you. So they have to pass that first course, 2 levels below. If they pass it, they have to choose to enroll in the next course. And what we find across campuses is that they often don't. Even if they're successful, they don't enroll in the next course. You familiar with this on your own campus? If they enroll in that second developmental course, they have to pass it. If they pass it, they have to enroll in the college level course. So you see what I mean? So there's at all of these places, life intervenes. You know, they might have done a fine job in the class. You might have done a fine job as a teacher. They might have had a great experience, but they pull off at some point along the way, right? And then the more layers you add, the more exit points you add. So if they started 3 levels below, they have 7 exit points. Okay, so this is some data from my own college. We have a developmental option in our English sequence where a student can start two levels below. And this is actual three-year cohort data. So for fall 2006 cohort, students who started two levels below in our English sequence, within a three-year window, 66% of them passed that first developmental course, either on a first or a repeated attempt. 93% of them enrolled in the next course. I don't really know how we're pulling that off as a college, because there's not a lot of intentional structures around that, but it's good. If they enroll in the second developmental course, 75% of them pass it within the window. 91% enroll in the college level, 78% of them passed inside that cohort. Are you clear about that? So those numbers don't look that bad, right? Right? That first course, 66%, we'd say, okay, we would really like for that to be a little higher. But this is the thing that I learned from Myra, that this is all one big multiplication problem. So, you know, even though the individual percentages, some of them are actually quite impressive, 93%. But you have to multiply those all together to get what percentage of the original cohort completes the college level course, because it's 75% of the 93% of the 66%. Are you with me? I often, just for my fellow English people, I needed to have this explained to me multiple times before I really understood it. Math people are like, of course. But English people also feel like I'm pulling some kind of hocus pocus on them at this point. So I sometimes say to the math people, this is true, right? This is empirically true. I'm not manipulating you with numbers. Okay. And so then when you do the multiplication, you get a very disappointing number, which is only 33% of the group that started two levels below has completed the college level English class within 3 years. Are you with me? Okay.
So we wanted to pause here just for a moment and sort of talk about these numbers from the perspective of community college faculty. And until very recently in California, and I'm wondering if this is true in Oregon, we would not have had access to the data that told us that 33% of that original group who was starting two levels below were actually completing transferable English. What we would have had access to were the course success rates, right? So as a department, we probably would have looked at that 66% and said, you know, we can do better. And we would have focused just on that number. Okay. So we want to go through that exercise for a moment and sort of think about the implications of the way that we traditionally think. So we want to think about that 66%, which if we did have access to the persistence data actually is the worst factor. So let's look at that. And let's just brainstorm as a group for a moment what you might do typically in a math department or an English department where you were trying to increase the success rates for a given course that you were offering. So what are some things that you might try? Additional tutor. Yes, good. So outside of the classroom, sending students to other support services would be a very typical response. Good. Anything else? What are the things might you try?
Yes.
Good. So sort of aggressive interventions where you're really saying, I noticed you weren't here, we missed you, come back. So yeah. And students often interpret that as you care, right? You know who they are, you notice they're not there.
Good. The
okay, so looking at sort of a programmatic approach, making sure everybody's getting sort of the same experience in each section of a given mm-hmm. course. Good. Professional development around mm-hmm. that maybe. Mm-hmm. Great. So sort of a pairing things, looking at learning communities that are highly mm-hmm. integrated, paired courses. Okay. Anything else? Yeah.
Ensuring that students are working together in the class so they have a secondary gain from coming to class.
Okay. So sort of a collaborative learning environment where students begin to feel responsible for themselves and for each other in the creating community. Okay, so you're looking at sort of placement issues, right? How students are actually getting into the course, right?
Mm-hmm. Another version of the linked classes and learning communities where you're combining the content course with the college success course.
Okay, So maybe a learning community where you're pairing with something that's offered maybe in the counseling department around college success or study skills, those kinds of things. Okay, so what we want you to do is we're going to do a thought experiment where we imagine that we have implemented all of these things, okay? And again, our goal here is to try to think about what would the impact of all these beautiful interventions that you named, the professional development, the tutoring, the adding a support course on, the collaborative learning, what if we implemented all of those things and thinking about what the impact could be on that 66%? So I think on the next slide, we're going to actually have you do this. So we'd like you to get out some sort of calculation tool. So your fancy phone that allows you to multiply, or you need to be able to multiply. And we don't want you to do it by hand. No extra points for by hand, right? We want you to use technology.
And folks who are at home on different locations, please take out a calculator and go through the thought experiment with us.
Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to divide the room up into thirds, and we actually want you just to physically go through this exercise by doing a calculation. So if you're in sort of this end of the room, we're going to pretend that your department has actually implemented all of these things and had some phenomenal success, right? So that 66%, you've gotten it up to 75%. And for the purposes of our thought experiment, we're going to keep all the other factors the same. So we're going to assume that the interventions you've implemented have only impacted the first course success rate. It's moved from 0.66 to 0.75. So you're going to plug that 0.75 in instead of the 0.66 and multiply across. Again, what you're looking at is the impact on the final completion rate of improving a course success rate.
And
okay.
Keep, and don't shout out your answer. So
yeah, just keep it to yourself.
But you can quietly check with each other to avoid embarrassment.
Yes. Middle group.
Yeah.
Middle group, you have done even better. You've gotten that 0.66 up to 80%, 0.8. So that's the factor you're going to plug in. And folks here on this other side of the room, you've become now famous and have your pictures on billboards because you've gotten your developmental course success rate up to 90%.
Across all sections, yes. Full-time, part-time.
So plug that in, do your calculation, and then we'll see what happened.
How are we doing on time? Okay. You coming back? How's my... Okay. Up to 75% across all your sections, very impressive. What percentage of your starting group went on to complete that gateway course? 37%. Okay, so you got a 4 percentage point gain by getting that first course success up to 75%. Okay, middle group, you got yours up to 80%. So what's your cohort completion percentage? 40%. Okay, and then rock stars of the community college world, 90% in your first lowest level developmental course across all sections, full-time, part-time. What was the payoff for your cohort completion rate? Okay, we can round to 45 generously. Okay, 45%. So I feel like every time I do this activity, I still have a little bit of shock about that, that you could get your first course success rate up to 90% across all your sections and have the other numbers be very respectable and still only have 45% of your starting group completing that first gateway course in English or math. Yes?
For comparison, do we know what the persistence is for students who enter at college level and then go into a transfer program or into a CTE program?
So if you're entering at college level, you sort of are at, all you have to do is get through that course to be part of our metric, right?
It's the same as your gateway. Yeah, so we're, just to sort of refocus us on, the thing we're gonna talk about today is developmental students completing the college level, first college level gateway requirement. So we're not, that's a whole other really important area, because the exit points in students' path, this same principle that we just walked you through applies throughout the whole program. So you, even if you increase your percentage of students that get through the gateway course, they still have to get through everything else, and life still will pull them away. So it's an important question, but I feel like we're not going to focus on that today.
And so today we really are focused on an intermediary measure, right? Yeah. We're really just saying that passing a gatekeeper course is imperative to transfer, yeah, but of course it's not sufficient, right? There's a lot of other things that students have to accomplish. But we're just focused today on that intermediary measure of, can they get through the gatekeeper math and English courses that they need to complete in order to transfer.
So we're happy to take questions now, and also Kathy Lindsay is going to be offering questions from the field. So we'll start with a few in the room and then see if folks out there.
The questions so far are the tech ones. So
okay.
So when we're asking them and getting group response, either you repeat or we'll do the roving reporter thing.
Okay,
so
great.
I have been repeating what people have been saying,
yep,
so we'll continue to do that.
Yep.
Okay.
But there are people watching. That's the exciting
yay
part.
Yay!
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yay,
and
Oregon.
It's working. The tech is working.
Okay, I saw.
We have one more comment.
Yeah, we'll start here and then go to you. Next.
These numbers for the first course count students who are headed towards a 100-level class and technical programs, or just the 100-level?
All right. So I'll just talk just a moment about what you're bringing up as sort of a confounding factor in any data, any pipeline data that you look at nationally and certainly in our state, and that is controlling for students' academic goal. Now, it is very hard, if you look at the literature, to gather accurate information about academic goals, because when students, at least in California, and I think this is true if you read Tom Bailey's research too, that the data that you gather when students first enter the institution is highly unreliable in terms of what their actual academic goal becomes. So you are right that we don't have a way to tease out students here who would have lower requirements based on their program. Now, I will say when we look at some math data later, we have done some surveying, at least in the college district that I'm in, and I was very surprised to find that students who are in pre-algebra, the vast majority of them, when they first come in, do plan to transfer. Mm-hmm. Now, they might change their mind later as they begin to have trouble with their mathematics. Some of them decide to go into vocational programs, but when they first come to the college, they do. Their initial intent is to transfer.
And any associate's degree at my own college, and in California actually any associate's degree does require the college level English requirement. Now, are there CTE programs that might require some English, but it wouldn't be all the way to college English? There might be, but they're actually a very small percentage of our overall offerings at the college. So you raise an important point, but I think it's a relatively small percentage of the data that we're looking at here.
And what the point we're trying to make, which I think we'll make in the next few slides, is that any time you're dealing with developmental students and you have a sequence that they work through where they have to get through one course in order to be allowed to take the next course, you are going to see attrition in the pipeline. So if you look at the next slide, we just worked out some of the, so that you don't have to do all the calculations.
Do you want to do this epiphany story?
Yeah, I'll do it after this.
Okay,
usually.
Okay.
So if you just looked at, for instance, students who were starting three levels below, so in math this would be like, let's say, in pre-algebra, if we were able to get pre-algebra, elementary, and intermediate algebra course success rates up to 90%, and we were able to get 90% persistence rate, so we would still be getting less than half of those students through a transferable math course. So I think once we sort of own the fact that there is attrition in any pipeline that we have, it leads us to the conclusion that we really need to think about ways to shorten pipelines and make the learning experiences more intensive. So I'm going to tell you a brief story about how I came to a realization about this in my own practice. For years, I was the coordinator of the developmental education program on my campus and still actively teaching in the developmental math program. And we had one of these large federal grants, Title III grants, multi-million dollars, you know, over 5 years. And we were focusing on completely redesigning the algebra sequence. So we contextualized all of the curriculum. So students, it was collaborative learning. Students were focused on activities that dealt with their electric bill and things like that. All of the concepts were contextualized. We had every faculty member, including our adjunct faculty who were teaching those courses, met every single week. They observed each other's classes. We class tested activities and revised them based on what students were doing. We wrote exams together. We used assessment results to go back and revise curriculum. It was really phenomenal work and work that I was incredibly proud of. We met every single one of our federal grant goals, which of course were framed in terms of increasing course success rates. So we increased all our course success rates in the algebra, each course in the algebra sequence by 10%, and we maintained that over the 3 years of the grant. And actually recently I did program review and we had maintained those 10% increases over the last 10 years. But I, at the time, asked the Office of Institutional Research to do a pipeline study for us at the end of the grant. And I was very confident and feeling very proud of the work my department had done. And I asked them to take any elementary algebra student who had started at the beginning of our redesign and trace them for the 3 years of the grant and tell me the percentage who had completed transferable math. And it was a dismal 17%. So I was devastated, right? Because we had all of this impressive work we had done, we had met all of our grant goals, and yet only 17% of students who were placed into elementary algebra were making it through a transferable math course. So I started asking myself, what would it take, right? What would I have to see in my department to actually see an improvement in that completion of transferable math that is something that we could be proud of? And I began this thought experiment and very quickly realized it was impossible to actually get that completion rate at a level where we could hold our head up as math faculty, right? And what that led me to was the understanding that if we keep the core structure the same and the length of the pipeline the same, we are never going to see increases in those completion rates that we can be proud of. Mm-hmm. So are you with me on that? The premise here, and for what we're going to talk about for the rest of the day, the premise is that we have to shorten the pipeline. Okay, so we've got to rethink about the structure, and we're not even talking about content yet. We're just talking about the actual structure of the pipeline that students are part of when they come into the community college.
So just to sort of underscore what Myra's saying there is that this is the bottom line that we start with faculty in California and in presentations we give in other states, is that we'll never significantly increase completion rates of college-level English and math unless we reduce the length of our developmental sequences and eliminate all those exit points where students fall away. And I think it's especially true for students where you're dealing with high rates of poverty, you know, because just think about the complexities of their lives and the forces that are pulling them off track, that the longer their educational program is stretched out over time, just the more opportunities there are for that. So that's not our fault. We don't have control over the poverty in their lives, but we do have control over the curricular structures that we place them in. So there's a real potential around knowing what we know about our students and what happens to them as we stretch out their programs, we could design something that would work better for the students that we actually serve. So this is our working definition of, when we talk about accelerated developmental education, our working definition is that it's curricular restructuring that reduces sequence length and eliminates exit points. And ideally, we think there should be a reconsideration of curricular content. So is what we're teaching what students truly need to succeed in college level English and math? And on the math side, that really opens up a lot of questions. But on the English side, it does too. Sort of the way that we've laid out our sequences, where we say, before you can do this, you need to be able to do this. Before you can do this, you need to be able to do this. Therefore, three levels below we offer you this, two levels below, we are, you know, that I think that that really the, all of those assumptions, it's very fruitful work to re-examine those. And just like Myra said earlier, the key outcome that we're encouraging the faculty who work with us to focus on is what percentage of students from different starting placements go on to complete college English and math. That's when we do our redesign, that's what we're hoping to influence. You do, yes.
You have more exit points, but have you, sometimes in the colleges we've worked with, we don't have very many on the quarter system, we have some. But sometimes the quarter system, because those are more intensive and shorter, they actually can do very interesting things with redesign because they already are seeing the students more hours, you know, in that. Mm-hmm. So it's sort of like a bunch of summer school sessions stacked on top of each other. So I think sometimes the quarter system can actually work to your advantage mm-hmm. because you already have an intensity of instructional hours there.
Are you all in the quarter system, the whole state?
Yes.
Oh, interesting. Okay. Yeah. Yes.
Changing the framework of how we do things at the college. You know, the college has 11-week quarter, you know, mm-hmm. 11 weeks. And that's how our classes are designed and their schedules are done. And so it's bigger than just the curriculum, it's changing the institution of how
yes.
we...
How you block
how
your
we
scheduling.
Block our scheduling
yeah.
And
yeah.
how faculty mm-hmm. do their schedule, you know, and how the
yeah.
whole system
right.
We're so entrenched in that.
Yeah.
Right, we are. So some of the things, we're going to share some models with you that don't require a major restructuring in the kind of blocking that you're talking about, though we do have some examples that are not part of our presentation where colleges in California have done that we could talk to you about.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's very much worth considering, but it can be a little daunting because it would be such a major change,
yeah.
right, for the institution.
Mm-hmm. So we're going to share, after this, we're going to share some in-depth information about acceleration models from our own colleges. But before we do that, we want to make clear that there are many possibilities for doing this redesign. And I really think the way to make this work and be vital is for you to design it locally in a way that is consistent with your culture and your values and the constraints that you're dealing with institutionally, the quarter system. So what we hope you'll take away from this are some principles and some options, not we must be faithful adherents to the religious model that, you know, I am offering or Myra's offering. So that's why we're starting with some of the possibilities. I think of this first one as like a gateway drug into acceleration. You know, like the compression model. So you don't have to reconsider whether what you're actually doing in those courses, you know, makes sense or is worthwhile. All you do is you package up what are two separate courses into yeah. one course taught by the same teacher that the students enroll in at one time. You know, so classic is elementary and intermediate algebra. You know, you're not questioning whether everybody needs all that algebra content. You're just delivering it in a way that reduces exit points, and you see gains from that. There are gains from that. City College of San Francisco used to be famous. There was a New York Times article a few years back where they were famous for having one of the longest developmental language sequences like in the world. And it was like five levels below college English. And it had previously had separate reading and writing too. So there's just, you know, you just don't get out. That's the Hotel California. You could go in, but you can never leave. But what they've done on a very large scale is to say, okay, the class they were three-unit courses. Now it's six-unit courses that combine the two and three levels below. And then a six-unit course that combines the one level below and the college English. And they teach the course to the higher level outcomes. So you're starting from the whole semester of aiming for the higher level outcomes of that package. And that students who don't quite get all the way there can get 3 units of credit and still advance inside the traditional sequence, so it's not a kind of all or nothing. That's a nice model, and it's politically, if you have political charge on your campus around this sort of stuff, it's politically a little easier entry point. Mechanisms for bypassing remedial levels in math, those sort of intensive, yeah? City College, San Francisco.
Yeah.
Mechanisms for bypassing remedial levels. So intensive math reviews and retesting is one of the ways to do this.
Sort of boot camp experiences. I think Achieving the Dream actually has examples of this. College is working with sort of, you do a quick boot camp and then you can retake the placement test, and that they see that students really are able to jump at one or two levels in mm-hmm. their placement.
Yes.
How long are the boot camp classes?
They vary. Chaffey College has one that's 3 weeks long. And they have found that students, the majority of students who, and they start with the arithmetic four levels below, and that the majority of students who complete the 3 week experience place into intermediate algebra one level below, and then they offer a late start. So you can inside the one semester. And again, you didn't have to question whether everybody needs that algebra content.
And I think what they found there is that they're using adaptive placement instruments. So if a student couldn't add fractions without a calculator, they were not even allowed to demonstrate that they could do algebra. They had algebra skills under their belt. Mm-hmm. So just by doing a boot camp around that was really focused mainly on arithmetic issues, those students actually were able to progress through the placement test, show that they could do the arithmetic, were allowed to take the algebra portion, already could do enough of that to place into intermediate algebra. Mm-hmm. So there are mechanisms like that that don't, they're not very politically charged, right? They're just mm-hmm. about trying to help students understand how high stakes that placement test is and to be prepared for it in a way that they're actually being placed at a level that's respective of what they do know.
Okay, so another model that I suspect a lot of you have heard of is enrolling students into college-level courses and providing well-tailored co-requisite support. So the Baltimore ALP model is the best example of that. So they take students who would have been placed one level below in their college writing. They have separate reading and writing, so they still have reading co-reqs or, you know, that sort of thing. But the students who would have placed one level below are able to go directly into a college English course with students who officially placed there. And then they have this small group, 10-person support class taught by the same teacher that happens immediately after the college English class. And they get support on what to, you know, let's work with the readings that this essay is based on. Let's do some in-class writing around it. Let's do some peer review, like additional supports to meet the higher level of challenge. And it dramatically increases the completion of college English, dramatically. Integrated reading and writing courses that replace multiple separate levels of reading and writing. And inside Oregon, do you have variation in this? Or I saw from somebody's question that when you saw English, you had assumed that meant English not reading. But in my own campus, English is reading and writing. We only have an integrated. We don't have a separate reading curriculum. So where are you? Where are y'all in that? Across the whole state, 17 colleges? No? What college are you?
Central Oregon,
okay.
You have to repeat it or we run around.
Okay, Central Oregon has integrated, but a lot of other campuses have separate reading and writing is what I'm hearing. Okay, so that's another way to, anyway, you think about you, now you have not only math and an English developmental sequence to get through, you also have a separate reading sequence which adds to your opportunities for exit. Yes. Okay, so it's the other issue of separate developmental and English departments. Do you have separate credentials required for teachers? You know, just a bachelor's at the developmental level? And that's okay. Some states, like in the South, have that.
Not well aligned.
Yeah. Okay. So that can be a kind of a something you need to grapple with if you're looking at a redesign, is if you have like one TERF controls this, the developmental, and then another TERF controls the college, and there's maybe a disrespect or an, you know. So yeah, all of that comes into play, yes. So Myra is gonna share about pre-statistics courses that replace the traditional algebra sequence. You'll hear a little bit more about that. And Statway is doing that, and Uri Treisman's MathWays project in the state of Texas is also doing that. So that's a sort of an idea that's starting to get traction nationally. And then contextualized instruction inside career technical programs. So I really, you know, if you're going to be a diesel mechanic, you know, and you need to work with that textbook that has like multi-layered indexes and technical terminology, and I don't think I am the best person to support you in reading that. I just will say that, you know, that sort of, that I really think that it's that diesel mechanics person who uses that kind of a text is the best person to apprentice you in how to approach that text. And so thinking about it that way, that inside career technical programs, thinking about, well, what are the literacy and math demands inside that field, and how could we create accelerated models that embed them inside the demands of the field rather than a generic English sequence taught by a generic English teacher. Okay. So we're going to start on the English side. This is a model in place on my own campus, Chabot College. It's called English 102, Reading, Reasoning, and Writing Accelerated. And it's a one semester, four unit developmental English class, one level below college English. So one semester, one level below, integrated reading and writing. We don't have any separate reading and writing. And it's, yes?
How long is your semester?
Too long, 17 and a half weeks long. How long is my semester? 17 and a half weeks long.
So a semester is 17 and a half weeks.
Yes.
It's almost two quarters.
Yes,
in our area.
I understand. Thank you for the math, yes. Yes.
As you talk about this course, you may also be talking about the actual contact time that you have, that the instructor has, and the type of instructional packaging you do.
Sure. Yeah, I can do that right now. So it's four, the student gets four units, but there are five contact hours. And so what it looks like is, part of it is lab and part of it is lecture, but lab doesn't mean somebody else handles it. It's still all class time for me. But it's so a class I might teach might start at 8 a.m. on a Monday, Wednesday, and go till 10:10 with a presumed 10-minute break in between. So really, it's like a two-hour class block twice a week. Yes, which is too long, because that just adds to the weariness and fatigue on behalf of the students and me and the So I think that's too long, but that's what we have. It integrates reading and writing, so we don't have a separate sequence. And it is real, like, I really feel like even though I started as calling myself a writing teacher, the reading is the most essential thing that we do in class, is focusing on the course, the assigned reading. So in the afternoon, we're going to do a lot of in-depth work on inside the classroom to give you a feel for that. But this is just a little introduction to the model. Yes?
I have a question about what you mean by that college transfer reading and writing class, because what classes? Because what we have in this state is we have a class called Writing with a Teacher at most community colleges. That transfers to a four-year institution, but it transfers as elective credit.
Oh, okay. Oh.
The 121 class is the one that counts for a bachelor's degree.
Yeah.
In most of our career technical programs,
okay,
which is some colleges,
yeah,
most of the students don't even have to get to that class.
Okay, yeah. So that, when you're designing locally, you'll want to think about what is the gateway course that you want to track students through and maybe do a more fine-grained pathways approach to that. In my own campus, if you're getting an associate's degree, you do need to take this freshman comp. It's the freshman comp class. So a transferable course, they're pretty much the only one we offer, is this English, we call it English 1A. Other colleges call it 100, 101. It's the freshman comp class, the transferable freshman comp class. And it's three units long.
And it is required for the state AA degree.
Yep.
So
and
if
for
you
transfer.
Want to get a community college degree, you actually, in the state of California, have to pass freshman comp.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So again, think about your own situation,
right,
and what these general principles mean in terms of your situation, as opposed to trying to align the specifics of your system with the specifics of California.
So one more thing I want to say about this course that's really important because it's so different than how almost everybody does it nationwide is we don't have a minimum placement score for this accelerated course. So it's a one level below course that you can skip Accuplacer completely and sign up for my class. One level below, college English, completely open access. We also at my college offer a two semester version of our developmental pathway. So you can sign up for a one semester four unit course, or you can choose a two semester eight unit developmental pathway to get you to college English. It's up to you. We don't give you any, we give you a little diagram that explains the curriculum, but we don't, based on your score, we don't try to direct you to one or the other. The principle of the Chabot English curriculum overall is backwards design. So we have the philosophy that to be ready for a college English class, you should be practicing the exact same things that college English class is going to ask you to do. So if you're going to have to read books and write argument-based essays, drawing up text, drawing upon text, that's what you should be practicing at the developmental level. You shouldn't be doing workbooks on grammar. You shouldn't be doing process paragraphs about how to make a tamale, because a good college-level course is not going to ask you to do that. And so that's not what you should be practicing. So that's our philosophy. That's our starting point. And I think it's really helpful when you're thinking about accelerated curricular redesign is that this facilitates the acceleration rather than saying, no, before you can do this, you got to do this. Before you can write a paragraph, you got to be able to make sure your sentences are tight, right? That's a different way of thinking about English curricula. And this now is our dominant developmental pathway. We used to be, we only offered a few sections inside learning communities. That's like 15 years ago. But now, in fall of 11, 75% of our entry-level developmental English sections were this accelerated course. So it's our majority. Most of our students are enrolled in this because that's mostly what we offer. Although it's politically contested. So there's inside the department, there's a back and forth about how many, you know, that there's we've gone too far on the acceleration, we need more of this. And, you know, like any college, there's political. Yeah. Yes?
One thing we find at Clemson Community College, probably at least statewide, not nationwide, is that the students' sentence structure, paragraph structure is abysmal. Now, if we're not going through and teaching them the grammar, maybe as a side issue, how do we improve that sentence structure? We teach grammar and punctuation within the essays and writing that they do.
Mm-hmm.
Do we present it
yes.
to them first and then say, I want this kind of structure in your writing or how?
So we're gonna really dig into those kinds of classroom-based questions in the afternoon. So thank you for raising it. I will say that any of the sort of remediation issues of like you have sentence level patterns that need to be cleaned up or your paragraphs are a little bit woo, you know, but that happens inside the context of the more challenging task. So you, in order to write a synthesis essay in my class, you're going to need to have some paragraphs in there. And so we'll have a little bit of just in time. And if you in particular have a problem, Kathy, I really think, you know, this seems to be just following your own random thought pattern or, you know, like just, I'm going to talk to you about that and give you some feedback. So it does get addressed, but not in the sort of front-loaded, before you can do this, you have to do this, or that's what shifts, I think. And how we teach it, I think, shifts. Yes.
Thanks for taking one more question. I want to make sure I understand what level this course is in terms of like sort of comparing it to the Oregon.
One level below.
So this would be, and you integrate reading and writing,
yep.
And it's one level below
transferable
composition.
Yes, the college level freshman comp that would transfer to you 4 year for comp credit. Yeah.
But there's no prerequisite, so
no prerequisite.
Any student could
yes.
register,
yeah.
And they do for this course.
Yes.
Thanks.
The full range of AccuPlacer scores are represented. Yep. Yes. Wait, Elizabeth, could you come over with the Oprah or Sally Jesse? Who is it who does this? Sally Jesse, yeah.
My question is about the after these students finish this
on
English 102, how do their persistence rates in English 1A?
Thank you for the data question.
And then subsequent to that, how do they persist onto whatever else? They, you know, using that.
Yes, sing it. Good job. Okay, so here I was feeling like I wanted to get onto data, but so thank you for the transition. So here I'm going to answer first. On our the needle that we are talking about all day long is what percentage of developmental students go on to complete the college level class. Here's the data. So you saw the data on the left earlier, the 33% figure. Are you with me? So and do you notice that the left hand bar graph has more bars? Why? Yeah.
Yay.
Thank you. Yes. And the one on the right has fewer because there's fewer places where they can drop away inside the sequence. And the effect that that has on how many get through is huge. So instead of 33% of the original cohort, it's 56% of the original cohort completing the college English class. Where in educational interventions, if you've been trying to, you know, doing learning communities or adding a success course or adding tutoring and trying to influence your numbers, where do you get that kind of gain? Where have you ever seen that kind of a gain? And at scale, look at how many students this is. This is like, this is our whole curriculum. This is not a, just a pocket of a few beautiful, dedicated teachers. It's everybody. You also asked, but how do they do inside the college level course? So this is showing you how many of the original group actually complete the college level course, which is what I would say we really need to be focused on. But then once they enroll in the college level course, are they as well prepared? Are they maybe flailing? Are they not passing? Are they failing out? That's the worry people have about acceleration, right?
So before we move from this slide, I wanted to just make clear that these percentages, the student has to make a C or better in the comp course to be counted here. So it's not just that they're there at the end, it's that they've actually successfully completed the comp course.
Yes.
Is this trend continuing in 2007, 8, 9?
Oh God, I love it when people ask
this
questions
so
and
great.
I have the slide.
We have a slide just with your name on it.
Yes, so this is, here I'm showing you the cohort that is fall 2006, I just picked it from. So, and some people might say, well, was that a fluke year or is that, you know, and also we've changed our offerings. It used to be that we had very few students in the accelerated, but now it's the majority. So has the gap between the two pathways changed over time? And the answer is, it is incredibly consistent over a decade. Incredibly consistent. The accelerated group completes College English at 23 to 26 percentage points higher than the non-accelerated group across the decade. And even though we've moved almost all of our students now into the accelerated path. So it's like we're not just getting the most motivated, the most skilled. This is just our student population is in the course, right? And it's always 23 to 26 percentage points higher for the accelerated group. Okay.
A quick question. I noticed that this is their pass rates over, you're looking at a 3-year span.
Exactly.
Is there a significant difference if you look simply at a 1-year span?
Yes.
Versus a 3-year
it
span?
Is higher. The accelerated group has even higher completion compared to the non-accelerated group.
So it's taking into consideration students who do stop out for a little while and then come back.
Exactly. And Community College Research Center is about to release a study where they've done it over also a 5-year window. And so the non-accelerated group, the gap between them narrows a little bit as more time goes by, but not a lot, because as more time goes by, more accelerated students come back and complete too. So both, you know, they're just always ahead, you know? Yeah. So I wanna also look at, so this is, the gap is incredibly consistent over time. Even as we've moved more students into this pathway, we're not seeing higher failure rates or more, you know, problems. And then this is how they do just the students who enroll in College English. So not of the starting group, but of the students who enroll in College English, what's their pass rate compared to those who had twice as much instruction? And the answer is they do as well or slightly better, the accelerated group. So they are not more likely to sort of flail and bomb out inside the college level course. And they're not taking it with the same teacher in most cases. They're taking anybody's English 1A. They're going across the curriculum, lots of different teachers with lots of particularities and things that irritate them and, you know, all the, you know, they're doing more than 80% of them pass the college level course. And that is comparable to the students who had much more instruction. And there's just more of them that do it. Just, we didn't lose as many. Yes?
I just wanted to kind of clarify for context. So you actually had 2 or 3 or even 4 classes that were below your gateway class in a semester system.
No. Chabot, we have 2 semesters or 1 semester.
Okay, now, currently.
For the last 20 years.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it's just either two semesters, which would be a full year.
Right. Yep.
Or 1 semester.
Right.
Which would be a half year.
Yes. Exactly. Other colleges in California that we're working with, like City College of San Francisco, had 5 levels below. But we at Chabot, even though we're just across the bay and serve a very similar student population, right.
I'm
had that.
I'm thinking in terms, you know, for amount of time. So that would be the equivalent of 3 quarters for us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you had 2 classes, that would be 3 classes for us.
A year.
The same amount of time.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Other questions? Kathy, any questions from the?
No.
Okay. Okay. Good. Yes.
I'm not even sure. I would imagine there are many, many sections of
many, many. Yep.
How do you ensure that everyone is
using the same curriculum and having the same outcomes, I'm assuming it's part-time and full-time
yep.
instructors?
Yep, oh, absolutely.
So what's the mechanism for ensuring that they have the same outcomes and essentially the same curriculum?
So the primary mechanism at my own college, and this varies widely across colleges, at my own college, it is we have a shared curricular philosophy statement that is up online, and we have a lot of sample assignments, and some of the philosophy includes things like every teacher is expected to have students read at least one full-length nonfiction text at all levels, whether they're teaching the two levels down course or the accelerated or the college level, that's something that we share. The principle of integrated reading and writing is something we share. So the philosophy sort of articulates it, but then there's a lot of faculty autonomy within there, and there's a lot of variability. So I've sometimes looked at success rates across sections, and my hair gets a little bit whiter when I do, because it's like, oh, you know, this in the two levels below course, this person has a 12% pass rate, and this person has a 90% pass rate, and what is the, I'm sure the students are not that different, you know, so I think it's an issue inside. We have a fairly decentralized, autonomous department, that's our culture. But the other thing I would say is that even without something like a common final or a common portfolio, some colleges have things like that, that this shows me that there is probably enough consistency that I'm not that worried about it. So if all these sections are producing such high pass rates inside the college level course, and that these rates are consistent over time, it seems like there's some mechanism of coherence happening and quality control happening even in our more decentralized way. Okay. And so that's it for Chabot. And we will in the afternoon, we'll be able to dig into, so whatever questions remain for you at the classroom level or at a data level, we're going to begin the afternoon with just a sort of a, you know, sort of maybe 20 minutes or so where you just kind of field your questions, and I'll take them down and we'll make sure we address them in the afternoon. But I want to move us along, but rest assured that we're going to continue the conversation. Before we go to the math side, I want to go to just a couple of other models of acceleration that we have data from, because they're working with us inside the California Acceleration Project. So Fullerton College is where I'm going to start. Fullerton College wanted to be part of CAP, and we require that you offer two accelerated sections for you to join the community of practice. And they couldn't get it through curriculum in time. So they did a super creative thing, and they just said, okay, we're taking four sections of our two levels below course, and we're going to designate them accelerated. And we're going to teach the hell out of those sections. You know, like just like, we're going to teach those sections to the outcomes of the one level below course. So we already, having learned what we learned about placement, we understand that it's not giving us very meaningful information about student capacity anyway. So what if we assumed they were capable of meeting the higher level challenges and taught to those, and worked together collaboratively to design shared curriculum and support each other in this new venture? And so that's what they did. And this is just from their first spring pilot semester last spring. 102 students enrolled in the two levels below course. 88% of them completed the full semester. They didn't withdraw, which is really high for California, really, really high. 78% of them passed the course, the two levels below course. And of those, 22% were not ready to go all the way to college English. Even though they were teaching them to the higher level, the students weren't judged based on their portfolios to be all the way there yet and ready. But they still could pass pass into the one level below. But 59% of the students, 60 students, were, based on that one semester, ready to go to the college English. And so they used a prerequisite challenge process to just skip them. They just skipped them right over the one level below course. And so 59% of them, this is just one semester's worth of data. 59% of those students were ready to go to the college level course. And when we look at comparison data for students in the two levels below, over 3 years, only 48% of students is ready to go to college English in 3 years in the traditional pipeline, compared to 59% for this group in one semester with no repeats.
So, and Katie, this group was actually instructors who across sections read portfolios.
Yes.
So it was a not just an individual instructor making a decision about whether the student was ready to skip the next course and go mm-hmm. directly into the college course. They actually, as a group, looked at portfolios.
And it was the four people teaching these accelerated sections and part of our community of practice. But then they invited some other people from the department who might have been a little suspicious or skeptical of this to also look at the portfolios, and that's how they made the decision. And this is an easy, just like, again, gateway drug into acceleration. Like, people who are excited to try it on your campus, but you don't have a new course in place yet, you could try this as a way. And it's very low stakes for the students, because if they don't get all the way to college readiness, they still could advance in the sequence. So it's a good model. Yeah. Yes?
How many students are typically in a classroom?
It really varies based on the union contract at each college. At my own college, it's 27. At this college, I think it was 25. At Baltimore, it's 20. So I don't. At some colleges, it's
45. At some colleges,
yeah.
So really, we have separate unions for each district in the state. So it's widely variant mm-hmm. about the number of the class max that's negotiated.
And then I just want to give you one more model in English before we go to math. So Butte College created a new four-unit course that's one level below transfer, but it is for students who had placed two levels below. So they could enroll, instead of taking two sequential courses, they could just take this one course, and instead of it being two three-unit courses, it's one four-unit course. And I love the way this is sort of laid out. So the traditional sequence, 100% of students enrolled two levels below, that doesn't apply in the accelerated sequence. Nobody enrolled two levels below. Even though they were placed there, nobody actually had to enroll in that class. 72% passed the two levels below, again, NA for the accelerated group. So do you see how we've already lost 28% of students before, while we're still having 100% of students in the accelerated? That's the pipeline effect. 59% of the original of the traditional sequence enroll one level below. Now we have 100% of the accelerated group. So if you go down to passing the transfer level, 31% of the traditional sequence cohort and 45% of the accelerated sequence. And this is in their first time doing it. They were, you know, piloting a new thing when you've been teaching in one way for, you know, that's not easy, and you're sort of figuring it out as you go, and you feel like, God, I can't wait until I'm revising this, you know, and actually have a better sense of what I'm doing. But even with this being their first year of trying it, this is the kind of gain they got. And the other thing to say is that the traditional was tracked for 3 years and included repeats, and the accelerated was tracked for 1 year with no repeats. So to see that kind of a gain without even having repeats or the same time period shows you the promise. When you think about redesign in this way, you can really have a big impact.
Read by the instructors, were they just from the English classes or were they across the curriculum?
They were just from English. That's typically how it goes if there's a portfolio process. The other thing I'll say is that this group, they did a departmental holistically read final, so anonymous for the Butte group. They didn't do a portfolio assessment, but they have a departmental final that's holistically read. And the accelerated students who were who had been technically placed two levels below outperformed the students who had been placed one level below on the anonymously holistically graded final. Part of my point here is also, and this is going to get stressed later, placement is not giving you good information about what students are capable of. You know, and they're actually capable of a whole lot more, which is sort of more fire under redesign your sequence to tap that capacity.
That
yes.
My question I was going to ask you to speak a little bit to the prerequisite challenge process that you mentioned before. Is it a departmental thing? Is it an institutional?
It's locally designed at the colleges.
So it's not just retake the placement test?
No. I would recommend you don't do that because a placement test is a bad instrument anyway.
Right,
yes.
Right.
Yeah.
And so that's kind of what I wanted.
Yeah. No, it could be as simple as a department chair signing off. It could be that the teachers themselves could just write a thing that authorizes it. Every college handles it differently.
But it is in California state mandated. So it's in our ed code that students have the right to be able to challenge a prerequisite based on the claim that they have the knowledge and skills to succeed in the course that they want to enter. Mm-hmm. And so every college has to have an established process to allow students to challenge prerequisites, mm-hmm. but that's locally designed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes.
I have a question about the amount of faculty time compensation for reading all these papers. We've tried to do that in the past, and it could never be done systemically because faculty members require release time for
right.
teaching. Mm-hmm. So how do you guys handle that?
You mean the portfolio process?
Yeah.
Most colleges aren't doing that. That was a local process that Fullerton developed in part because their colleagues were suspicious. So their department actually doesn't do portfolio, but because their department was suspicious that these students really aren't, they're going to just be passed through or something. So they were like, okay, we're going to do portfolios and we're going to invite you to be part of that. So it's, I don't think that departmentally that's how they want to set up their entire curriculum, although Berkeley City College is doing that.
And I think, don't they, Katie?
They actually do a dead week.
Yeah, they do a dead week. So they actually have permission from the administration to take a week at the end of their semester instead of in the classroom. They all meet and read portfolios. Mm-hmm. And they read it across courses. So it's impressive.
So a student might be placed two levels below. The student might be in a course one level below. The student might be in a college English class. The teachers who are assessing the portfolios against the college English competencies don't know what class the students were in. It's completely based on their performance on those outcomes, those college English outcomes.
I was just going to mention, too, as we are talking about these models, if you jot down the one that resonates with you, we can put you in contact directly with people who are running those things mm-hmm. so you could ask more detailed questions. But I also wanted to say on my own campus, the English department, we went through a big thing around how to sample portfolio, because they do read portfolios for most of their courses, and they rotate it, so they don't do it every semester for each course. And we went through a long thing about what would be a good sampling technique. So they now are at the point where they finally believe that sampling is a valid way to make conclusions about the success of a course. They rotate it. So, one semester they'll read all of the paper or a sampling of papers coming out of the course two levels below but their purpose is different than this. It's not to determine if a student can skip a course. It's really just a course assessment kind of strategy. But anyway, there's lots of things that you can do to make that less onerous, right? Mm-hmm. If you don't decide you have to read every single paper, but you decide what your goal is in the assessment, you can use sampling.
Oh, sorry.
Oh, yes, sir.
Yes, good job.
I just have a transcripting question because in the accelerated sequence, students who are two levels below who might have finished, they didn't receive an A, B, or C because they couldn't show the competency. What do they get? Do they flunk?
I'm just asking.
How are they transcripted if they don't meet the competency at the higher level, but they are perhaps still meeting the competency at the lower level at the end of the course?
So
Fullerton's method.
So let's go, because I think you're asking about Fullerton there. I think you're conflating models is what I'll say first. I think that, so it will vary based on how you set up your model. At Chabot, we have just that one course. The student decides they want to enroll in a one semester course, and it's 4 units, and they pass it or don't pass it. They might work really hard, make a lot of growth, but if the teacher at the end says, oh, I don't think you're ready to go to 1A, you get no credit. Which is, I think, part of why some of my colleagues are nervous when I try to push us toward making acceleration the dominant path, is that it feels bad to give a no credit to a student who might have worked hard and learned a lot but still not be ready. The Fullerton model is a nice alternative to that. So they can pass the course one level below, and they get, I don't know if they do a letter grade on this or if it's a credit, no credit class. I'm not sure how they set it up. I think it's credit, no credit. They can get credit for the one level below course on their transcript, but not be skipped through the prerequisite challenge process directly to 1A. They just go on to the one level below course. I think my colleagues would be more comfortable if we had some kind of mechanism like that.
So the way I'm understanding that Fullerton does it, the student actually is enrolled in a course on their transcript that's two levels below. And if they don't meet the competencies for getting into to freshman comp, what their transcript says is that they successfully completed the course two levels below, and they're eligible to go into the next course, which is one level below. Mm-hmm. If they do get to skip, they go through this prerequisite challenge process where the system just clears their ability to enroll in the transferable course. Mm-hmm. So nothing else appears on their transcript except for a passing grade two levels below and now a registration for the transferable course.
Right.
Yes. And my question was similar in that it's the logistics as far as students paying tuition and registering. Do they register for both courses? If they only pass one course, do they get a refund? If they
no, again, that depends on the model. So it's not when the questions come and say, "Does it work like this?" I say, "Well, it depends on the model." So in Fullerton, they're only enrolling in the two levels below course. That's all they've enrolled in. So they're only paying for one course. They are passing it or not passing it, and then they can skip or not skip, but that's not enrolling in a course. That's just.
But like at City College, where they have the compressed model that we were mentioning, City College of San Francisco, the student pays for the entire six units.
Right.
But at the end, what they might actually get course credit, so it's a multiple unit course, what they might actually get credit for is just three units if they don't meet competencies to go into. Does that make sense?
Of the
so
higher
they
level.
Don't get any kind of reimbursement.
No.
They sign up, they register, they pay for the course, and then what actually appears as unit credit depends on their performance. Does that make sense?
And the thing I'll say is that is logistically hard on their campus to back a student
and they're
out.
Huge.
Of,
they're huge. Yeah. They're the largest community college in California. They're huge. So that's been difficult.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. All right. So if there are still English reading writing questions, I'm sure there are. Just keep notes for yourself, and we're going to have a really in-depth conversation, just us English folks, in the afternoon.
Okay, so now I'm going to talk a little bit about the pre-statistics program at my college. And again, Katie talked about a large variety of models that colleges are using on the English side of the house. In the California Acceleration Project, we have only worked with colleges in math who were willing to do some pretty radical things. So in the state of California, there is a lot of compression going on with elementary and intermediate algebra being taught in the same semester, for example, but I don't work with those faculty. What I'm doing is working with faculty who are really questioning the mathematical content that they're offering, and they're focusing. One thing we have in common across the 21 colleges that I've worked with is that we are focusing on students who do not intend to major in a math-intensive field. Now, in our colleges, and most every college in California, that is the vast majority of the students, right? Because we are always, and my college still has right now, a very large grant to try to grow the STEM path, right? The science, technology, engineering, and math path. And we're still trying to get students into that, and we're doing a lot of beautiful work there. But where my work focuses is on the hyper majority of students who are not interested in a STEM field or business, but do want to get a baccalaureate, right? So it's all you English folks, right? And students that would be interested in journalism and history and psychology, those kinds of students. And that's true with all the colleges that I work with. Now there is some difference in what colleges are designing. So their pre-statistics course, what we have in common across the colleges that I'm working with is that they have to shorten the pipeline, right? So they have to rethink the number of courses students have to take. And essentially colleges are doing one of two things. They're doing what they do at my college, which is we have a course that is intensive. It's six units, it's 8 hours of instruction a week, so it is intensive. But let me contrast that to what they would do if they were taking elementary algebra. That course is five units with 7 hours of instruction. So we're just adding a unit and 1 hour instruction relative to what they would normally do for us in elementary algebra. But there's no prerequisite on the course, so that's a totally heterogeneous environment if you're thinking about categorizing students by their placement results, right? So we have a heterogeneous environment. If they successfully pass the pre-statistic course, they are eligible to take the transferable college-level intro stats course, okay? Now, where that varies across the colleges is some colleges have put in a pre-algebra prerequisite, and I think that is partly just their own nervousness. and political realities of trying to get something through their department, where there was a lot of concern about students who were assessing at the arithmetic or pre-algebra level. All right. So at my college, we, and this is true of all the colleges we work with, like Katie was describing, there is a principle of backwards design. So I discourage colleges from just taking their big fat combined elementary intermediate algebra book, right, that has like 600 pages in it and weighs, you know, 22 pounds. What a lot of colleges want to do is take that book and just go through and circle all the topics, right, that they're going to continue to teach the non-STEM students. I actually encourage them not to take that kind of a perspective. I encourage them to do what Katie encourages folks in English to do, which is to look at the transferable course that you're trying to get students into. Now, at my college, I'm at a fairly small school. We only offer transferable statistics as the only choice you have if you're not in STEM, unless you're an elementary school teacher wannabe, and you take a special math course for those folks. So the vast majority of non-STEM students go into statistics at my college. So we design backwards from that course. And what we mean by that is that when a student comes into the course, they need to feel like they are already taking statistics. So the idea is that you're leaving all the math baggage at the door, the fear, right, that comes from seeing that polynomial polynomial expression on the board. All of that does not happen because we don't front load. They come in and we begin on day one with some data analysis. The course focuses primarily on data analysis. We don't do any inference for you math folks. It is descriptive statistics, but the entire focus is quantitative reasoning in the context of data, making decisions using data, modeling with data. So the student really feels like they're in something very, very different, right? It doesn't look or smell or feel like the other math content that they've had before. Now, are there places where they need to know some things about percentages? They need to know some things about linear functions? Yes. And we do cover those things, but they're not front-loaded. So as we begin to get into a context where they need those ideas, we begin to build those in. And you can imagine, maybe this resonates with the English folks, that a lot of times you hear students say, when am I ever going to use this? And the only answer I have ever had in the past is sort of a snippy on the final, right? Which is not a very satisfying response. So this, I think, really part of what the bang you get out of this is that students are very motivated because the questions are real life, they're big, they're interesting. There's a lot of creativity built into the way students can answer these open-ended questions, but they all involve data analysis and mathematics behind the data analysis. So all that stuff is built in after they've begun to grapple with these big, interesting questions.
Can I just step in and say, looking at this as a non-disciplinary person, that it is really interesting stuff. So an example of one of those motivating questions that students are grappling with is College of the Canyons is one of the colleges we've worked with. They do an insurance problem where they give the students a whole bunch of data about car accidents and types of cars and different and their job is to make they work for the insurance company, and their job is to make recommendations to the company about policy changes that would be economically smart for the company. So they have to use this data. Now, that's about as well as I can describe it. What more sophisticatedly are they doing inside there?
So that problem actually comes up in a unit that's really just focused on descriptive statistics. So they take that data, they have to make an argument, and they have to produce graphs, right, that support the reasoning, and they have to use numerical measures. So they're comparing things like the mean and the standard deviation, sort of measures of, you know, typical accident rates for a given type of car, how much variability there is within that data, and then a recommendation based on that. So there's lots of problems like that that colleges and across the colleges, we do share curriculum, but it's not prescriptive. So we have a big drop box of things. Faculty, and I'll talk more with the math folks about this, but right now I'm supporting two different curricula and a third one I'm adding on that allow people to design their own thing. So they basically go in and pick things that they want to use, but they have sort of a general direction, whether it's project-based curricula or something that's sort of a pseudo problem-based curricula. So I do have different things that I support faculty in doing. At my own college, we've been offering this since 2009. So this is the world's worst slide. You don't need to be able to read it. You don't need to be able to read it. Don't worry about trying to read it. What you need to be able to see are those orange marks. Can you see the orange marks when you're looking at the slide? Can you sort of see the highlights, the things that have, you know, been highlighted? That's what you need to be able to see. Now, what this is I took this into my department when I was first trying to get them to offer a pre-statistics option. And I took an elementary intermediate algebra book that some of the faculty were using that had all the content topics, and I just asked them to highlight the topics that they felt were the skill set that was necessary as prerequisite knowledge to do well in statistics. So not things they wanted to be in there or things that they thought were important for an informed citizenry, anything like that. Just what do you think is really necessary to do well in statistics? And this is the union of what they highlighted, which Katie always tells me that's a math word. So it's like, well, I went around the room and anybody who highlighted something, I highlighted it on the master list, right? So this is sort of the grouping of what everybody picked. Now, what this is supposed to demonstrate, and what was sort of shocking to the math faculty who actually did this, is how little of the developmental curriculum is actually aligned with statistics, which was the course that most of our students were going into. So we were having huge attrition, you know, the 17% that I told you about that actually made it through a transferable math course, huge attrition in the developmental pipeline, a beautiful algebra-based curriculum that the federal government paid us millions of dollars to develop over 5 years, and the relevance of that curriculum to the course that students were really taking. And we had just never thought about it before. So it's really what I'm advocating is a rethinking of mathematics based on where students really are going to be using mathematics in requirements for their baccalaureate, but also statistics gives you a beautiful way to build in meaningful, real-life mathematical thinking skills, right, that are needed when you read the newspaper or you're trying to understand medical information that your doctor's given you that's communicated in rates and things like that.
Okay. Can I just say, as an English person, I had no idea about this, about the disconnect between the algebra topics and if a student goes into statistics. I had no idea about that. And I think that's, in California, we had a lawsuit about 15 years, when was the Maldef lawsuit?
Oh yeah, 20 years.
Mexican American Legal Defense Fund had a big lawsuit against the state of California's community colleges around using prerequisites in sort of ways that were really, had huge equity implications.
Disproportionate impact.
And I just think like, oh my God, the lawsuit in this, like we are blocking students from a college level statistics course and this is all that they would actually need from those two courses to actually be successful in that. This is like
indignation coming from the English side of the house.
Yeah. I just, but also like, wow, that's.
Now I will say too, I've been working with Katie for years, and she is very quantitatively oriented. So Katie does all of the data analysis you looked at from her program. Katie did that, and we're going to show you some data analysis that she and I did together using a statistical package that my developmental students use. So I think that I'm not arguing that people just need to get through their math and not use it. What I'm arguing for is a more meaningful set of mathematical skills that we work on that people like Katie, who are going to be quantitatively oriented in their chosen field, but they're not going to be in a math-intensive field, right? She still would get out of this experience mm-hmm. the skills that she currently uses when she and I always are doing data analysis mm-hmm. together. Okay, so here is a small set of data. So let me emphasize here. Katie's program has been running for over 15 years at her college, very large data set. This has been not running very long at my college, and I'm at a small school. So the data set here is small. It actually is larger now, but we lost our institutional researchers, so I haven't actually been able to get them to go through and take the placement data and map it onto what's happening in the course. But when I did get them to do this, we had 119 students that were taking the pre-statistics course that we call Path to Stats. Now, what you're looking at here is that any student who was enrolled in that 119 in the pre-statistics course, we made them go down and take the ACCUPLACER test. So we know where they would have normally been placed in the sequence. And what we did is by placement level, we tracked them through transferable statistics. So for example, when you're reading the intermediate algebra row, what we're saying here on the right-hand side is that there were 22 students out of the 119 who could have taken an intermediate algebra course instead of the pre-statistics course, but they chose to enroll in pre-statistics. Out of that 22, 18, which is 82%, passed transferable statistics the following semester. Okay? So here again, we're not looking at course success rates, we're looking at the actual completion of transferable statistics. Now, when you look at the data, it might not be surprising to you that if you look down the right-hand side, where we're describing the students who took pre-statistics, that the lower their placement level, the lower the completion rate is for that group. Now, when my department first looked at this, they were very concerned about that 38%. So the students who would normally have placed into pre-algebra arithmetic but instead came in and took the pre-stats, right? Only 38% of them successfully completed transferable statistics the next semester. Now, if you just looked at that, what they argued with me was what? Mari, you need a prerequisite on that course, right? But what I argued is, compared to whom? So I asked them just to look at the first column and look at the percentage of students who were taking our intermediate algebra course who successfully completed any transferable math course in 3 years. Right? And you can see that it's a smaller percentage. So I think there is, in my view, still a lot we have to learn about helping students who are coming in with numeracy issues. But to me, those numeracy issues are at the core of the kind of thinking that you do for an informed citizenry. So I don't think we need to abandon those students and put them into an arithmetic course. I think we actually need to learn how to better address those skills, and it will benefit everyone in the class, right? Because the things they have issues with are really understanding rates and percentages, particularly when those things get into more complex settings.
Inside the accelerated pathway in the context of the data analysis rather than the standalone skills before you can do the data analysis.
And I will talk more with the math group this afternoon, but the one thing that intellectually I have found the most exciting about this work is really rethinking, if I'm looking at a content topic that would normally be in our arithmetic course, so something like percentages, rethinking the learning goals around percentages when I'm trying to prepare students to be able to think statistically. So really understanding that percentages are a way to scale two unequal sized groups, right, as if they were all had 100 people in them so that you could make comparisons, thinking of percentages as a scaling factor, looking at percentages that you would want to construct to make comparison groups to make an argument. Those are not things we would ever deal with in arithmetic, right? What would we do in arithmetic? Can you convert this percentage to a, you know, fraction, et cetera? So I think it's what's been really exciting to me is to rethink the learning goals around those traditional content topics that would normally appear in a much lower level course. Okay, so this is just a little snapshot. And I think we should always ask, you know, when we're looking at achievement data, did the students really learn, right? So you got them through, they passed the statistics course, but what did they really learn? So we did recently do a study where we looked at students who began in the pre-statistics course and we tracked them through statistics. And we looked at, okay, so the pre-statistics students who actually enrolled in statistics, we took that group and looked at the percentage that passed statistics. So the course success rate for statistics for these two groups, those who came from intermediate algebra versus those who came from pre-stats. And you can see that it's comparable. So no harm done, right? No harm done. At other colleges, we've actually seen vast improvements. So the students who come from the pre-stat actually are doing much better in statistics than the intermediate algebra completers at other colleges. In my own department, we do periodically do a departmental assessment based on the final exam in statistics, and we all use a common final exam. And you can see here that the students who had started off in pre-stat but took the statistics final exam did very well on that final. So they were, 100% of them were proficient on two of the three course learning outcomes that we assessed and 82% on the third. They also outperformed the honors section that semester. So that was really a beautiful thing to compare the pre-stat students who were scattered across all these statistics sections, how did they perform versus the students who were in an honors section. We also had a PhD student from San Francisco State University did this for us. We looked at how these students performed on a set of multiple choice items that came from a national statistics exam, trying to just see how they performed relative to a national average, and they performed very well. So I think any concerns that we have about we're leaving a lot of math out that they normally would have, are they really prepared? When we look at learning measures in statistics, we see that they haven't been shortchanged, right? Okay. All right, and then just a little bit of data from some other colleges. This, again, very early data. All the data that Katie and I are showing you from other colleges are from their very first pilot year. So for instance, at City College of San Francisco, in the traditional path, 17 to 19% of the students would be able to complete a transferable math course in 3 years. But the students who went through the pre-statistics path, they had 37% complete the transferable course. Now, there, that is quite a bit lower than the completion rate at my college. And when we dug into that data a little bit, we noticed something that's really important. And that is that the students who completed the pre-stat, in order to get into statistics, had to go through a fairly arduous prerequisite challenge process. They had to go down to admissions, get paperwork, fill out paperwork, get signatures before they were allowed to enroll in statistics. And they just, by the time they got all that completed, the statistics courses were full. So we had a lot of students who were ready and weren't able actually to take the course when we were collecting the data. At Cuyamaca College, you can see that they did better than my college. So they had a 81% of the students starting in pre-stat successfully completed statistics in one semester. And one of the things that they were doing there was sort of a pseudo-learning community. So they worked with the same instructor. So the instructor who had them in pre-stats also had them in statistics. And they had various pre-stats sections that fed into a single statistics, but they all had the same teacher. And I think they got quite a bit of bump there. The last row is from College of the Canyons, and they're doing something that I wish my college would do, but I haven't been able to swing it, which is they teach the pre-stat and statistics all together in one semester. So when they do that, it's hyper-accelerated. They do have a pre-algebra prerequisite, but you can see they get an incredible gain in completion rates by that very intensive experience. Now, some people might feel skeptical about that, but I think the analogy is appropriate to think about. If you really want to learn Spanish, do you take a bunch of Spanish courses or do you go to Costa Rica for a semester, you know? So I think that's what this is. This is like a very intensive immersion. They probably would be only taking one other course besides this paired pre-stat stats. They get it all done in one semester and they do really well. Okay, are we doing this now? Mm-hmm. Okay, so we decided, Katie and I always like to show a little bit of classroom video to sort of give more of a face to all of this data. And Katie will be sharing with the English folks some video from her classroom. But right now we're gonna show a little 5-minute clip from my class, and I wanna give this a little bit of a setup. I had a former student who, the first semester that I offered the pre-statistics, he came in and videotaped most of the classes. And what you're going to see here is 5 minutes from two class sessions, clipped back to back, and he completely put this together. So I want to give a shout out to Jose Reynoso, who not only did all of the filming, but did all of the editing and chose the music. So this is Jose's look at my classroom. Now, I also want to say that if you're a math person and you're noticing the students are making mistakes, yes, this is learning in progress. So what you're going to see here is lots of students at different levels of confidence with course vocabulary, students at different levels of accurate, you know, use of certain things. But they're grappling with a problem from that national statistics exam or a preparatory quiz for that exam. And if you're an English person, don't worry if the content isn't making sense, because it's pretty sophisticated statistics content, but these are the pre-stat students, okay? So they're dealing, remember, it feels and looks like statistics when they're in that course. And they're dealing with a problem that actually cannot be solved like numerically or with a symbolic calculation. It's a problem that you have to reason through, okay? So this is 5 minutes. There should be okay.
Hello, my name is Brittany, and these are my classmates. I'm in this new math class at Los Angeles College that is designed to get students ready for transfer level statistics. There is no prerequisite. This class works for students at all levels. If we weren't in this class, some of us might be taking pre-algebra, algebra 1, or even algebra 2. What you are about to see are a few short segments from our class when we investigated a problem from a national statistics exam called the chaos exam. Here's the chaos problem that we are debating.
Okay, a toolbox class below displays final exam scores for all the students in 2 different sections of the same score. Which section would you expect to have a greater standard deviation than the exam scores?
Okay, so the standard deviation is a measure of spread.
But this one has a larger quartile, but this has more data.
No, remember quartile is still the same. A quartile is 25%. And the only difference is when it's spread out like that is that there's more variability.
So which one has a larger standard deviation?
A, right?
Because there's more spread in it.
Wait. So if we're looking at spread in this one has a much greater deviation there.
But some deviation is there. Is there a spread from the mean?
Okay, but there's
also
data over here.
Good, okay, now that I look at it, like, this standard deviation, you know, it's a number, right? So, from here to here...
Are you still disagreeing or agreeing?
No, I'm just... Wait, hold on, I'm thinking.
Wait.
Oh, Lord.
I pretty much agree with Risa. Because if you look at it, section B starts way before the before section A, but section A ends further away. And if you look between the second and third quartile, they're about the same.
But if you look at section B, like, it's skewed to the left a little bit, wouldn't that be still about equal? Because it also has more spread going to the left. That would also be that would also change the numbers when you're calculating the standard deviation.
So section A has more spread towards the outside, and section B has more spread to that side. Okay. So technically they'd be about the same.
My answer was A.
Okay.
So the standard deviation is the distances from the mean, right? The average distance from the mean. And most of the data has to fall within the distance, right? So I say it's A because it has because the range is bigger, you know? Because it has more spread.
Yes, but when if this happens, what section would you expect to have a greater standard deviation? When I think of that, looking at the whole data, not just the intersect, but interquartiles, it's looking at all four of them.
Right now, we're just looking at box plot. We don't actually have the exact data set. In the box plot, what I said, the box plot, each quartile is divided by 25% of the data set. We don't actually know the exact data set, right?
So we decided to make up a small data set to match the box plot.
We decided to keep it simple and work with samples of 10 numbers.
What we just did supports answer A, which is the one the answer key says is correct. Now our goal is to see what?
We're going to have another data set where section B would have a higher or a larger standard deviation.
We have proved that the answer for this problem should be D. It is impossible to tell. Either section A or section B could have a larger standard deviation. It is impossible to tell from the box plot.
High five.
Okay, who else got it? You guys did?
I
got it. So I think we have a few minutes just to talk a little bit about what we're seeing in that video, and then I wanted to do a segue into the last segment of our presentation, which is about placement. So I'm going to start there, and then if there are comments that you would like to make about things that you see, we can entertain those. I want you to try to think about those first three students that appear at the beginning of the video and take a guess as to what their placement might have been. So you have the one student who, you know, is confidently asserting a wrong thing about, you know, there's the quartile is longer, so it has more data in it, and she immediately gets corrected. So do you want to take a guess what her placement might have been? So she was an intermediate algebra placement. So she's, you know, in completely new content here, nothing she studied before, and she doesn't have a leg up, right? So she is making mistakes. Now Risa comes in and immediately corrects her. No, you know, quartiles have 25% of the data, so there's the same amount of data in each quartile. Risa was an arithmetic placement. So she was my top student that semester, and you can tell that she was incredibly confident. She learned things, thought about things deeply. You notice in the group she keeps stopping everybody till they're finally groaning, right? You know. So I think that and then Gustavo, let's talk a little bit about him, who I think is just brilliant. He was an elementary algebra placement. So Gustavo's the one who's saying, you know, that standard deviation is the average distance about the mean, and which is accurate, and he stops the whole conversation that's been going on for a while and says, we don't actually have data, so we're sort of stuck. He's the one who encourages the class to try to come up with data sets. Just brilliant, right? So he was an elementary algebra placement. English is a second language, from Nicaragua, living here with relatives. So I think that one thing this video says to me is that when I look out at my classroom, I have a paradigm that I see them through, which is you're an arithmetic placement, you placed into elementary algebra, right? And I can see why they got those placement scores, but that's my paradigm. The students don't view each other that way. And the students immediately see strengths in each other and defer to each other around those strengths. Like Risa was always the one who initiated the presentations for her group, you know. And yet Risa did have issues around numeracy that other people in the class helped her on, okay? So I think in a heterogeneous environment, the students see strength in each other and do not identify each other with the paradigm that I use, and it's because they're not working. I'm not front loading by saying we're going to first work on adding fractions. If I did that in the course, Risa would probably have been demoralized, right, and probably wouldn't have continued. Okay.
Yeah.
This is a brilliant example, by the way. That's really, really good.
I'd like to ask you, just out of curiosity, how often do the students go to the conclusion that A is not the correct answer and it is impossible to tell?
I think that they are always, in the classroom environment, they are encouraged to always reason. So there's always, I think, a questioning of, does this really make sense to me? And so this was the only mistake they found on that national exam, thank goodness. but you know, I think that they're in an orientation where it's not good enough to just say, well, the answer key says this. They really are encouraged to reason and think through things. So it's a thinking orientation in the class. Yeah. Did that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so did we want to just take a few minutes to highlight other things we saw?
Mm-hmm. I just wanted to ask a question about your observations about non-native speakers in the class. I imagine for a lot of the students, native and non-native, there's a lot of new vocabulary.
Yeah.
For non-native speakers, sometimes there are additional vocabulary issues that I understand can make math more challenging. Do you think the intensified or accelerated courses are more problematic for non-native speakers, or just in your observation, is that not an issue?
I personally do not think so, and I'll tell you why. I mean, you might have noticed in the beginning of the video, there's a lot of Spanish being spoken in the background. So frequently I find when, and at least in the students that I've worked with that are underrepresented, they tend to be Spanish speaking. So what I find in class is that they frequently will start talking in Spanish because they can't quite articulate what they're trying to articulate yet in English. But they, as they get more confident with what they're communicating, they then start looking for English ways to express those ideas. So, and I'm not bothered by that. And my Spanish is not very good. So, you know, they will sort of piece together some things, and then they gradually start trying to say that in English, or other people in the group will phrase it in English who are better, like Gustavo had very good English skills, so, you know, he could do that. So for me, I also don't load just my own pedagogical philosophy. I think it's a disaster in math classrooms to front load with vocabulary. I think it puts students into a mindset that they're trying to memorize, and I think it stops thinking in its tracks. So I allow this sloppy use of vocabulary till we're pretty far into almost everyone in the class understands an idea, and then we label it. So you will notice if you're a math person, there is all kinds of people really needing a vocabulary word, you know, grappling with it, stretching out more in this direction than this direction. So when I actually give them ways to describe that, they're ready for it, right? They have the idea they're trying to express, and I just give them the word for it. But I don't front load with that. That always comes after a lot of thinking has gone on. Okay, so for me, I think language is not a hindrance to students getting through.
I'll just say, and we can talk about this more on the English side because that's really a kind of core, but I think that it's partially about the collaborative pedagogy, that so much of class time is spent collaboratively processing in low stakes ways. So they're working with, this is a practice quiz before they're going to take a higher stakes assessment. They're working in groups. They're reasoning it out together. And so I think that that is also advantageous to second language speakers, that they get the space to work with, and native speakers, work with new language. So I think that facilitates learning a lot.
And some of the pedagogy that Katie and I share in our classrooms and we share with faculty, we're going to talk about in our breakout sessions, but it's intentionally designed to give students the opportunity to do low-stakes practice with articulating ideas. Mm-hmm. And so there's very intentional opportunities frequently in the classroom for doing that I think ends up building not only confidence with language, but actual use of
and clarification of things that they weren't clear about, and space to make mistakes without punitive.
Yeah, lots of opportunity for revision, whether it's in the spoken ways you're trying to explain or in your written work.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we want to transition toward a more explicit conversation about placement. The one of the sticking points that often comes up on the math and English side is this idea of open access classes. Her math class is completely open access. So students who would have placed into arithmetic are in the room. And in my class, you could skip the placement test. You could be a recent immigrant. And people get very nervous about that. And inside my department, it's still a very, you know, that there are people who are really, really defending the two-semester pathway because they're worried about the students who might struggle in the accelerated path, and it doesn't feel good to fail students. So this became a kind of a research question for me and Myra, in part as a sort of a political question, that I wanted to be able to say to my department, okay, yes, some students need the two-semester path, but it's just the bottom 10%. Or the bottom 15%. Let's get everybody else accelerated into the one semester or up into the college level. I would like us to actually do more of a co-rec Baltimore ALP model. But let's just, it's only this group that really needs the two semester pathway. And so we took 5,000 student records of 8 semesters worth of data from my college of students who took our two semesters down slower first course or our accelerated course. We have their Accuplacer score, and we have whether they passed the course or not. And we used the software that her students actually use in her class, Tinkerplots. Like, she installed it onto my laptop, and then we were on the phone together running the data through. I had got some just-in-time remediation. I still don't really understand how to do it very well, but in the moment I did, because I had good coaching. And the question was, is there a line? We were trying to say, like, is there a line? Is it the bottom 20% shouldn't be in the accelerated class because they really do better if they're in the slower? The bottom 10%, the bottom 5%. And the really interesting thing that was that as we looked at this 5,000 records of student data, there was no line. There was not a line. And so here's a sort of a punchline. So this is the bottom, less than the bottom 5%, this is actually the bottom 7% of Chabot developmental students. So in the total Chabot population, it's even lower than that, but it's the bottom 7% of Chabot developmental students had both reading and sentence Accuplacer scores below 50. Are you clear? That's the line. So bottom 7% of developmental students, and they still, if they enrolled in our accelerated class, they passed at a rate of 48%. And if they enrolled in our slower, make it a little easier for them, don't overtax them, they passed at a rate of 45%. They didn't even see a gain in the first course. And you know from the data I showed you earlier that the longer the pathway they're on, the more we're guaranteed to lose them. So if you don't even see a gain in that first course, what is the, you know, are you with me on this? What this? And it's shocking that the students who are in like lower than 5% of your total student population, their acupuncture score is below 5% for the total student population, they're still passing the accelerated one level below course at a rate of almost 50%. And at almost every institution, community college, nationally, they would be blocked from even trying that course, right? Students this low, and at states that have a floor for remediation, we might just write these students off completely to say they are not, what's that, ability to benefit. They don't have an ability to benefit. Well, if you give them a chance to show what they could do in a challenging curriculum, you might find that they, in fact, have great ability to benefit from this instruction. So this, for me, this just broke open completely the idea that we are getting meaningful information about our students from our placement tests and what they're capable of.
Are these the same number of hours per week, these two courses?
Same number of hours per week, but two semesters versus one semester.
But the data you're looking at here is just the entry.
Just the first semester.
Just the first course, and those
yes.
are the same number of
yes.
units and
same
hours.
Same number of hours, yes, exactly. Taught by very similar teachers, like people, we teach through, we don't have separate developmental and transfer level departments, so we all teach the whole curriculum for the most part, although I no longer teach the two levels down course because I don't.
But this goes against your intuition, right?
Yeah.
I mean, this is really creates some cognitive dissonance, and it did for us when we kept doing it. And I think, again, here the point is, in data analysis, you always want to ask compared to who. So if you looked at this just and said, well, only, what is it, 48% get through, or 45% get through our accelerated course, or whatever it is,
48%
get through
the accelerated course.
The department might look at that and say, well, that's not very good. You know, our pass rates for that course are, you know, 66%.
And this is lower than students with higher scores.
But
and that's how we
is,
set prereqs. We say, well, do the students with these scores do less well than the students with higher scores? Yes, they do, by 15 to 20 percentage points.
But the point is, if you put them into the course that's at the lower level, roughly the same percentage will pass it.
Right. So these students don't see a gain that you know, you've just made it maybe a little easier for yourself as a teacher to have fewer high-risk people in the room, but this group doesn't actually gain from having that prereq in place.
So I think this just really creates a lot of cognitive dissonance, and I don't even think everyone in Katie's department has really understood this.
Mm-hmm. Also, English teachers often don't like quantitative data. So there's a way that they're like, would you stop? You know, like, just stop bringing us this,
I think,
you know.
The other thing to emphasize here is that Katie and I were looking for a cutoff that could be used for a policy decision, right? Students below a certain level on the acuplacer have to take more remediation. And we couldn't find it. We kept lowering the bar and lowering the bar, and we kept essentially seeing this same picture.
Yeah.
But what I also want to say is that when we talk with faculty about this, they all have someone in their mind, a picture of a face with a name connected to it, somebody that they care about, a student that they care about, that they know could not survive in an accelerated course. And Katie and I do not argue with that. Mm-hmm. We agree that there are some students that are not going to do well in accelerated course. They're not going to do well in the unaccelerated course either. There are students like that, and we all have them in our minds. But what we're trying to say is that we could not identify those students up front ahead of time by their acuplacer or placement score, right? So that's the point we're trying to make. It's not that they don't exist, but they can't be identified ahead of time. And so if you are using, which we are in California, we are at our colleges, we are in the state of California, we're using these cut scores as if they are a definitive statement about student capacity. And as Katie and I have dug into this issue, And I'll have to just confess, I did all the statistical work at my college to put cut scores into place. So I have come through a major transformation in my own thinking about the validity of those instruments, right, and whether or not they are really helping us identify students who can't benefit from accelerated environments, and I no longer believe that they can. Okay,
there's a mic over there.
Yeah, Just out of curiosity, in situations where the students are able to choose, do they receive counseling and advising?
Minimally.
About that choice?
And less as the budget cuts have decimated our counseling ranks. It's just, no. I mean, nobody is getting any meaningful counseling.
Yeah, it's really sad. I mean, California recently saw that the ratio of counselors to students was 1,000 to 1 in general across.
Yeah.
So it's just like, you know, counseling is just not. And again, I wanted to emphasize what Katie had showed earlier, is that this is the vast majority of their offerings, right, are in the accelerated. So students, being students, they're choosing things that fit their schedule, you know, and what their main options are the accelerated course now in Katie's.
I think that there is a little, you know, people often ask about, are the student populations different in the accelerated and the non-accelerated? And the rooms can feel different. Like, if you're teaching the non-accelerated, there is a way that the room can feel a little different. So that leads you to conclude, these are different students who need something different, and so we have to keep offering this course. And the one main difference that we have found, we've done surveys of why did you take this course versus this course, and the biggest difference seems to be, if they chose the two-semester path, confidence is the issue. That they would check, I don't feel like I'm very good at English. I feel like I needed two semesters. But some of those students might have actually been able to fly. Like, think about like returning women who always underestimate what they're capable of, or, you know, that. Even if they chose the two-semester path with an intentionality, which some of them do, and some of them just didn't know about the accelerated class, I still don't necessarily think that necessarily is going to be the right choice for them, given what we know about what happens to them over time.
And how much they benefit from these heterogeneous environments. So when they're in an environment where there are some stronger readers or some students who are more confident about their writing, there's a lot of benefit, yeah, right, to mm-hmm. students in that environment, particularly when they don't know, they're not identifying each other by some sort of placement score, right?
Right?
They're just, yeah.
Who has the mic?
I do.
Okay, right on.
I've been hearing different curriculum redesigns, ideas, nationally, different conferences, and I just want to say, first of all, that this is really thinking outside of the box. Mm-hmm. But I do have a question regarding the students who do not pass the accelerated course. What do you do with them? How do you decide where to put them? And what do they feel about their new placement?
That's a good question. At Chabot, they get a no credit in the class, and I think I would say most of my colleagues are probably having conversations with them to sort of help them to frame that in a way that is like, you know, you have made great growth, and a no credit just means I don't think you're quite ready to go to 1A, but that doesn't, you know, so you have that kind of conversation with them. They could still choose. They have the choice. Do they take the accelerated class again, or do they think they need to start two levels below? Or maybe they really need to be in our ESL sequence that they wanted to try or in a rush, and really they accept that they just were drowning in the reading and writing demands of this class. So they still have those choices. We don't force anything. It is up to them.
I think another response to that is that Katie has actually done some really interesting research with her own students with something she calls the sustainability gap. So a lot of the students who actually don't make it through, it's she has demonstrated that they actually have capacity. They've done well on a small subset of the assignments, et cetera, before they disappeared. So I think a lot of the reasons students don't finish are not because of cognitive issues, it's because of all of the other things. So Katie and I this afternoon will talk to you some about the work that we do with faculty and what we call the affective domain to really set up classroom environments that support students, help them build metacognitive strategies, et cetera.
Reduce fear.
Yeah, reduce mm-hmm. fear, those kinds of things. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I was just going to ask, in terms of doing away with placement scores, if we go back to the opening of our session today when you had the video, Acceleration Means to Me. Aside from just shortening the path and lessening the exit points, it seems to me we're also talking about maybe a paradigm shift around the way we deliver and embody developmental. So people were saying things like, you know, acceleration means intellectual work, rigor, tapping into intrinsic motivation.
Yeah.
The affective domain, maybe reading apprenticeship, stuff like that.
Yep.
So if we take all of that stuff out and just say, oh, let's do away with placement scores, do you see what I'm saying? And we don't change the...
Curriculum pedagogy.
Yes. So, it's a ridiculous question, but
no,
do you know what I mean?
It's really not. Let me give sort of a math person's perspective on that, and then I'll hand it over to Katie. Katie and I actually met when our colleges had separate grants with the Carnegie Foundation for the Advancement of Teaching. And I had a playful relationship with the evaluator researcher for that project. And it was a number of colleges, I've forgotten,
13
or so,
yeah,
across California, that were doing all different kinds of innovations in developmental education. So some of them were doing learning communities, some of them were doing...
teaching communities.
Yeah, redesign within a single course, you know, so they were...
Supplemental instruction.
Supplemental instruction. So just a huge variety of things you would see. And so what I said to the researcher, just playfully, because I was already at the point of my thinking about these pipelines, is I said, I don't want to know what the college is doing as an innovation. I just want to know how many courses are in their remedial sequence. And I could predict within 5 percentage points the completion rate for every college. And the way I did it was I'd use 70% for course success rates and 70% for persistence rates. So if they had, you know, 5 exit points, I just did 0.7 times 0.7 5 times, and I could predict within 5 percentage points what their completion rates were.
Yeah.
Now, he and I joked a lot about that, because I think what that really showed is that there are a lot of other factors that go into building a good, coherent experience for students. But the one that has the most significant impact on improving completion rates is length of sequence. Now, that is not to say that we should just put them through. I mean, Katie and I, she sort of talked about the gateway, gateways into acceleration, where you don't question your curriculum. You just deal with structure. But Katie and I actually encourage that you think very deeply about curriculum and pedagogy within your redesign. And we're going to talk a lot about that this afternoon.
Because otherwise there's this feeling of being incredibly rushed. Like a lot of, and the first encounter with acceleration, and the word encourages you to have this thought, is that it's just about doing the same things faster. And the students are just falling away as you are rushing ahead. That's a sort of a mental image.
Yeah.
And I just think, you know, let's take grammar, because that was a question. It's sort of like, if you're really going to teach grammar, that the level of technical vocabulary around that, and it's actually incredibly hard to teach that. And but most students are using, I mean, students are using sentences every day, you know, that they're you know, and not everybody has noun subject verb agreement problems, and not everybody has, you know, whatever, or the native Tagalog speaker is going to drop the S at the end of plurals because his native language doesn't do that to make a plural, you know, so he's going to intermittently do that in his English, and I don't need to teach the whole class about that, right? So I do think that if you've been teaching in a way that really takes all the little sub-skills that go into writing and front-loads them in advance, and then just speeding that up, I think that's not going to go well.
That won't go well.
Yeah. I think you do have to question what are you focusing on?
Yeah.
What is going to be the biggest bang for your buck? What should you use class time on? Because you don't have as much class time. You don't have 3 semesters and a whole semester to linger in the sentence. You know, you got to get them writing essays.
The question that comes to my mind is that you're having a net reduction in instruction, both in terms of personnel and class offerings.
Yes.
So when you talk to your administrators, are they eager to jump on board because of the positive budgetary impact?
Not as much as I would think. I mean, I just like...
Let me say that we actually have someone who's doing a fiscal impact analysis for us right now in California. But I think that the argument I naively make with administrators is that, yes, they're going to have fewer instructional time needed in the developmental sequence, but where will they be then? They will be
in
your
lot more sections.
Transfer curriculum, and they'll be working in their GE courses, and so you're going to have a lot more throughput. So you're going to need to offer more sections of statistics, right? Things like that. So,
It's about reallocation of resources.
Right. And so we have someone who knows a lot more about that than we do, who's doing an analysis of the fiscal implications, and that'll be out, mm-hmm. Early midsummer.
If you can get many more students to complete this major milestone of completing a gateway course in English and math, which really pays off in terms of research about longer term completion.
I think,
for less money.
And some faculty worry about, because developmental education is a huge cash cow, right? Like at my college, 70% of the FTE, the load equivalents within my department is in developmental, 70%. So, people will say, well, gosh, if we get that, if in an ideal world, 10 years from now, we're getting students through and, a third of the courses that we need now, I say, don't worry, you're going to be teaching statistics, right? I mean, it's not that you're going to not be there and not be needed. You're just going to be needed for the courses, frankly, that most faculty would prefer teaching. So mm-hmm. I think that's the way we talk about it. But anyway, we'll send you that publication if you're interested when it comes out in midsummer.
So since we're talking about structural issues, some of the research has shown that part-time faculty teaching first sequence developmental courses in math, and then that students don't do as well as they switch into having a full-time faculty member teaching that next sequence. And this is research from, I think, Arizona, a dissertation. But there's been looking at some of the things concerning part-time and full-time faculty, and they're. So there is a structural issue, whether it's full-time, part-time, but also professional development. Mm-hmm. And so I wanted you to just address a little bit about what you're doing, with that bigger issue, because that's an important piece of the whole structural issue also.
Yeah, thank you for saying that. And I think as a state, when I presented at the OCCA meeting to the trustees and the presidents, that was one of my major points, is that inside California, it's been very grassroots. Each college is, faculty step forward because they want to be part of the redesign, and we support them. It's not top-down mandated. But there is a lot of professional development support. So on the math side, if you've been teaching in the algebra sequence, I didn't understand this either about your world, that a lot of people in math, statistics, they might be experts in one kind of math, but really not know statistics very well. So that some of the teachers working with us are basically needing to learn on the fly. They need to learn statistics while teaching statistics. Talk about no net, being on the higher eye or with no net. So that is needed to do a kind of a major pathway redesign in math, but also in English. If we've been teaching in a kind of and particularly around reading and writing, so reading teachers see this as my responsibility, these skills, but I don't grade essays for the quality of the writing, and the writing teachers are focused on reading process, but not necessarily spending a lot of class time supporting students to really understand the readings that they're giving them, or maybe not including as many readings or a density of readings. And so it can be a fairly major shift in paradigm in how you teach. And I think we have to do that in community with each other. We have to support each other on that. We have to share materials. We have to have a safe space to fail and try again and to see models. And I think statewide, the building collaborative networks of people doing this work and sharing with each other and sharing affective practices. How do you keep from having a lot of students drop out? There are strategies for that, but you gotta share those with each other rather than accept it as a given that, you're gonna lose 50% of your students.
So in the California Acceleration Project, if you apply, you have to have a team. Mm-hmm. So we do require that you have at least 2 up to 4 people. And the real theory of action there is that we work intensely with this team of go-getters, mm-hmm. right? They're the first to step up. But there's a responsibility when they go back to their campus, and they take it on because they want this to grow, mm-hmm. right? They want what they're doing to grow. So there's a lot of, I think, collaboration that happens that we don't even see back on the campus with faculty observing classrooms, looking at student work,
Sharing materials.
Sharing materials, yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I'm delighted to hear you talk about that, because it seems that my institution, the cut line is within the faculty, and it involves teaching grammar and punctuation. Mm-hmm. And so those in the college level classes have outright said that's not what they do.
That's not what I do either.
They expect students to be able to use commas correctly and make complete sentences before they come. And I have tried to use the dry sponge idea that it's only by repeated expectations and repeated exposure that any of us learned the comma rules and sure. other things.
Yep.
So I think professional development has got to be, if not the cornerstone, a cornerstone.
Yeah, I think what I hear there too is this idea that like the job of developmental education is to get the students all clean and fixed and tidy before they step into my real college classroom. And I just think, really? That's like, is that how you think human beings learn? Like, were you all clean and tidy when you first started teaching? Like, no, you continued to learn. It's all recursive, right? And as a writer, are there not still things that we're all learning about how to shape our craft? And so I do think that you need, it's not just about the grammar, it's really about an orientation toward growth mindset and ongoing development and mastery and refining that is all of our responsibilities all the way, and in the other disciplines too. Not like I'm gonna tidy up everybody's writing so that you in history never have to think about it. Right. Yeah.
So, you know, I think that's just a whole beautiful conversation we could have at lunch too around transference. So mm-hmm. even if you did a bang up job, how much of it really gets transferred as the context begins to change?
Right.
And, you know, if you do any reading and education research, not a lot gets transferred as the context changes. So I think trying to really start conversations about joint ownership across disciplines with reading skills, mm-hmm. writing skills within the discipline, including right things mm-hmm. to deal with constructing a paper, which mm-hmm. in math would look very different than it would in English, and using grammar within that context. Yeah.
We have a little bit more on the placement.
Well, let's just look at it and see if we. I don't. Do we need to talk any more about the placement, or do you sort of feel convinced that? You want to talk a little bit more about it?
You want a little bit? Okay, so here's, yes.
It means we're going to talk about placement again. I was going to, that was my question originally was, I think that I went on a very similar journey as to you. About a year ago, I was sent on this journey to find the magic placement number that was, okay, this is going to work. And it either didn't work out because I wasn't there or I wasn't capable of doing the task. I'm not sure which, but it didn't work out very well for me.
I'm certain it's number one.
I got the same results you did. There was no smoking gun that you could say, here's the magic line. And to me, I came up with the conclusion that our placement mechanism is asking some of the wrong questions.
Thank you.
And number one was motivational factors. We take a placement test and all we worry about is your mathematical ability and your ability to read and do some basic grammar. And then the other piece is just college life readiness skills.
Yeah.
You know, what's in place? Do you have a, what kind of mentoring do you have in place? Are you a first-time college student? Are you, what's your family history with college? I think those kinds of questions they're not in our placement.
They're not measured
test.
By AccuPlace or a Compass or whatever standardized testing implement you're using to assess sub-skills in, you know, reading, writing, or math, decontextualized sub-skills in these fields. Yeah.
So I will say that Katie and I think we still both believe this, that placement scores might be useful in determining what kind of supplemental support a student might be willing or interested in engaging in. So if you use them in an advisory way, for example, to say your sentence skills, you know, according to this instrument, need some work, but we're going to enroll you in the college level course or the accelerated developmental course, and you can take a, you know, half unit lab that's connected onto that, maybe taught with the same instructor that just gives you more personal attention around your sentence mm-hmm. level work as you're writing these college level essays. Mm-hmm. Something like that. So I think that they could be used to design innovative and interesting supplemental support
for students you think are at higher risk of not being successful, rather than this layering approach that nobody is going to do well being placed three levels below. That's the sort of structural. What are we using placement for? It's not only where is the line, it's what's the purpose.
Yeah.
And is it to zoom in with some intentional support but not put students further back? I think that's an interesting thing to explore.
But I do think all of the teachers though that we work with have let go of their, I don't even know the way to talk about it, their you know, indignation about, you know, this student doesn't even know how to. So, you know, they're in a pre-stat course, and this student doesn't even know how to, you know, convert a, you know, a decimal into a percentage. And I feel like, well, you know, let's give a quiz right now to this room and see how many people can remember how to do that. Big deal.
That's right.
I can handle that in 3 minutes, and we're going to be doing it so much in the course that you're going to get it, right, by the end. You know, some people might need a little more, and you're going to get it by the end, and that's where we want you to be. So I think that a lot of the teachers have taken ownership about just-in-time remediation as opposed to saying, you don't know this, you don't belong here, it's you don't know this, I need to think about how to incorporate that because you need to know it, right? It needs to be there by the end. So, you know.
I wonder, okay, so you're talking about getting students through gateway courses. And as we know, the purpose of these gateway courses is to support the student's success through the rest of their disciplinary courses or their CTE programs. Could you speak a little bit about how or if you work with disciplinary faculty? Because you mentioned reading, and I know some of my English counterparts, the reading of I think you mentioned nonfiction work is wonderful, but the reading that you will do in a biology course or a science-based course,
right,
or a step procedure course, chemistry, et cetera, is very different. And so there's nothing that a student could transfer.
Yeah.
Same thing with writing an essay.
Yeah.
It's not being written to the demands of a biology.
Of the discipline, right.
So that's my example.
So
thank you.
I think that's a really important question. And my own college has done some really interesting work around that, where letting go of this idea that it's the generic reading and writing teacher who's going to be able to prepare. Like, I really am not going to be great at preparing somebody for that diesel mechanics textbook. The diesel teacher needs to take ownership of apprenticing the students in that kind of literacy. And so there's this approach that was named earlier, reading apprenticeship, that works with disciplinary faculty. So how do you approach a historical text? What kinds of questions do you ask in your mind? What kinds of background knowledge do you try to apply? What, you know, that this, there are disciplinary ways of approaching reading and writing that are really not the expertise of somebody who comes from a retcomp background or a creative writing background or a lit background, all the ways that English teachers are trained. We can kind of try to make a pass at across the disciplines, but we're not experts in those disciplines. So I really think that that's another huge paradigm shift, is to say that reading, you know, that we all bear responsibility across the curriculum to support students' literacy. I can give them some basic tools as readers and writers and learners and a foundational skills. And success in English courses at Chabot correlates strongly with gains across the curriculum. So it's very, very strongly.
The other thing I think that approach really respects is that every discipline expert has and oftentimes it's latent and unexamined, right? But they have the expertise to read in their field with sophistication.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you can get faculty to think about that, to just get meta about how do you decipher a statistics text? You know, what is it that you do? And can you make that explicit to students?
Mm-hmm.
Disciplinary expertise has that, right?
Mm-hmm.
We just need to help them make it more explicit.
So that's another really rich opportunity for professional development, and we are the acceleration wing of 3CSN, the statewide professional development initiative, but there's also a reading apprenticeship wing. And so there's sort of work going on around the state supporting disciplinary faculty to support their students, because reading in the discipline is learning the discipline. You know, there's texts that are involved.
I would say, too, that critical thinking is the same way. There's some beautiful work around disciplinary approaches to critical thinking. So I think it's the same thing,
yeah,
right, that faculty really can work within the discipline to think about how to explicitly scaffold the kinds of thinking that's done.
So just back to the placement question, I want to share a little bit more of the kind of analysis we did to try to grapple with this question of, can all students benefit from an accelerated class? Are there some students who should be steered away from it? One way that we did this was to look at, because community colleges across California, ACCUPLACER is one of the most common placement tools, so we have the same instrument. So my students who have this score on the ACCUPLACER, they can enroll in my accelerated class one level below, but at a college down the road, they might be placed 3 levels below, right, or 4 levels below, depending on how they set up their curriculum. And so that was a sort of an interesting way to test out, could we find lines of like students who should or should not be in the accelerated course? And so we have friends at other colleges, and we call these College X and College Y, and we said, give us your Accuplacer cut scores. So if a student has this, how do you decide who goes one level below, who goes two levels below, who goes three levels, and both of these colleges had three levels below College English. And so then we said, okay, students at Chabot, who would have placed three levels below at College X, but they enrolled in our accelerated course, how do they do? If they would have placed two levels below at College X, but enrolled in our one level below accelerated course, how did they do? To see if, like, could we find a line?
Looking for that, yeah, that magic.
And so here's College X. What they do is take the Accuplacer and they weight the reading and sentence scores equally to arrive at their cut scores. And so students who would have placed at the transfer level at College X, 75 of them took our accelerated course because we have set our College English cut score way too high, frankly. Way too high. Our College English cut score is like 84% of students are placed below college level at Chabot. Way too high. Those students passed the accelerated course at a rate of 81%. If they would have placed one level below, 68% of them passed our accelerated course. Two levels below, 52%. But then if they would have placed three levels below at College X, they actually did better than the students who would have placed two levels below. Do you see that? 57% of them passed our accelerated one level below at Chabot. But all of it, and so yeah, like the higher students are passing at a little bit of a higher rate, but who would have predicted that, I mean, that those students are required to do two semesters of remediation at this other college, but 52 or 57% of them, two to three semesters, were able to pass the one semester course, accelerated course. Okay, this is the end.
But
right.
We have to do our homeless.
No, that's the end of the day.
Oh,
no. Okay. Yeah. Okay. We just had a little. We're back.
Yeah. We're redoing a few things.
Yeah. So this, we also had an institutional researcher at another college look at the same 5,000 students from Chabot and see, and he did a regression analysis, and this was his conclusion, that knowing a student's placement score does not meaningfully enhance our ability to predict whether that student will pass or not. And so I think that the main thing I want to say, there's like two parts of our argument. One is that the structural point, when you build a longer sequence, you guarantee you're going to lose more students in it. That's just a structural reality that doesn't matter how good of a job you're doing. But then the other point I always partner that with is, and students are capable. You know, that students don't actually need all those layers. That when we build well-designed accelerated models, they're really quite capable. And so that's the positive side of this work. So that's our last slide.
Yeah.
So this is our last slide, the sort of bottom line. We've got like 10 more minutes for just sort of more open-ended questioning before lunch, and then in the afternoon we're going to go into our disciplinary breakouts and have much more in-depth classroom focus and Q&As that are more disciplinary.
And then we are going to come back together, yes. All of us at the end of the day, to give you an opportunity to, we have some principles to give you a sense, so we can get a sense of the room on sort of where you are in your thinking at this point. And also just an opportunity to share anything that jumped out at you today, right? Sort of aha moments. So we'll all be back together at the end of the day.
Right.
Okay, so we have a few minutes left. Is there anything else people would like to ask? Or has this been a grueling 3 hours?
Thank you. At Central Oregon, we actually did this combination of reading and writing classes a long, long time ago, about 15 years ago. And we got those same dramatic results, and it was very exciting. And then there were sort of questions about academic freedom, and could we really force the part-time instructors to teach this program rather than doing skill and drill, and as long as they were meeting the state outcomes. And anyway, at this point, we're not actually seeing the results that we got about 10 years ago. It started to decline a little bit. So I guess part of my question has to do with college enforcement, getting part-time instructor buy-in. I mean, do we just fire the people who don't do that, or
yeah,
you know, what's the strategy? I mean, the initial stuff, excitement, everybody's in on it.
Right.
We designed a textbook where we had area experts come in for the writing across the disciplines part, give us readings, give us strategies. You know, and that's all kind of gone away over the last few years, and we're not getting the results that we used to. So what do you do about, how do you keep the momentum going for 20 years?
I think that's a really good, that's a really good question. And especially when you don't, so I'm in a two-college district, and we have different answers to that question, and that might be illuminating to sort of give you a sense of possibilities for your own local context. So my own campus, Chabot English faculty do not like to be told what to do. You know, like we just don't like it. But we have, back 20 years ago, there was a very in-depth culture-building process around what are our shared values, and that resulted in the articulation of our department philosophy, and it was done collectively. So no one person is telling anybody what to do, but we agreed about these shared values that we have, which include it's not skill and drill, and grammar is not taught in isolation. Some of our principles are really fine-grained, actually. And so in terms of academic freedom, if we have a part-timer who is, you know, I have done class observations where someone was teaching critical thinking through the most crazy, like, multiple choice that was complete, you know, and was not consistent with our departmental philosophy statement, and they got a bad review. Like, that's, and then they are expected to work with faculty to, you know, learn what is the Chabot way of doing it. And there's a lot of opportunity for creativity within that way. We choose our own texts, we design our own assignments, we work with the full-length text, we pick our own themes. But you, if you're teaching skill and drill, you should go to the college down the road, because we don't do that. And it's an ongoing process that involves informal sharing. Like, we have this thing called teacher talk, where we just get together and talk about a topic, and there's no enforcement feeling. It's very collective. And
so I was just going to say two things to that. One is that my college is maybe, what, 40 miles or something away from Katie's, and so we do share some adjuncts in English. And I was doing a presentation to our English department recently where one of the adjuncts that teaches in the accelerated course at Chabot was in the audience. And so I sort of gave him the floor and let him talk a little bit, because I wanted to use it as an assessment tool. I was like, I'm going to see if this guy really can talk in the way about the way that Katie describes the program, and he could. And so I felt from that when he was hired, you know, I asked him, did you get sort of a little description or a philosophy statement? And he was very clear on sort of the key principles, and felt like he could, you know, he picked his own books and all, but he had a very clear sense of what the goals were. You know, in terms of the philosophy. So, you know, I thought that was impressive. I think they get a lot of bang for the buck at hiring, you know, sort of trying to talk to people.
And using evaluations and using informal, and our website where we have sample materials, sample texts, and lots of hallway conversations. What books are you teaching?
But I think the other thing that underscores is that a lot of times when there is a lot of innovative work done within a department, and then you sort of see it dwindle away over the years, is that you're bringing in all these new people who don't hold the vision.
Yeah.
And it's very hard to hold the vision in a department. And I think maybe because I'm a math person, it has to be grounded in the problem you're trying to solve. So I have lots of memories of working with adjuncts in math that we couldn't get them to do what we wanted them to do. And some of them we did let go, and others we're still trying to work with. But I got further along with them when I just stepped back and said, instead of me trying to get you to do these things, I want you to understand why, right? Why we have come to the place we've come as a department, and really talking through the problem and having them read a couple of very short things so that they don't see my college as just a weirdo place, you know, that really is something that's connected to a large conversation about mathematics education. And that began to turn some people, you know, that they began to you know, engage more in the hallway conversations, ask for help when they were having trouble, that kind of thing. We haven't moved to this, and I'll just say this, it might be too radical, but I actually think that we should share course success rates across sections, because like at Katie's College, we see huge variability. And I wouldn't want anyone's name attached to it, but I certainly could see giving each instructor, full and part-time, a report at the end of the you know, a month after the semester was over, which said these were all the course success rates, and here's yours. And I think just helping them have a context so that they don't say, well, you know, every college I'm at, you know, 50% of the students fail elementary algebra. You know, I want to be able to say, well, at our college, the average pass rate is 72%. So if you really are down here, I think it just would put them into a place of thinking, one, do I want to stay here? And two, what are other people doing, right? You know, what is happening in those classrooms?
The one other thing I'd say on the English side, this is especially relevant, is on the math too, though. Our sister college has shared curricular units that they develop collectively and they review together, but they're often teaching the same thing, like that we're in teaching Fast Food Nation, and then, or we're in the a stereotyping unit, or what, you know. So, and the adjuncts are given this packet of materials, and it's a much smaller department, and it's all collaboratively developed and kind of owned collectively, and they have much less grade variability. They are much more coherent, and so I don't think Chabot faculty members would accept that, but it can work. It depends on your department culture.
You were talking earlier about how low the line can go. As a part-time faculty teaches both in the reading department and ABE, GED. So I teach everything from reading 117 to what is our levels 3-4 in
that
reading and writing.
That means nothing to us.
So in that, we have students who are reading as low as sometimes as a sixth grade level. How low could you go? If you say we have the exit points, if someone comes in, an adult comes into an ABE GED program and wants to get to college, at that level they've got, you know, maybe it could be 8 exit points. Could we sink it further and have accelerated models all the way through, or is there kind of a bottoming out point?
I think it's a really good question, and I have to say I don't totally understand the ABE world and its and how well it aligns with community colleges or because I think that some of the students that are in the room with me could just as easily have chosen to go to ABE and then be assessed in kind of different ways and receive a very different curriculum, but they are in my class and doing okay, you know. So there's so much embedded in the way that you ask that question that it's a little, one thing I want to say though is that I don't think about reading skills according to assigning elementary school grade levels to adults.
Yeah,
even as an assessment mechanism. I think that blinds us to our students more than it helps us target instruction to our students.
I was just going to say that I think there's a lot of work that needs to be done in that area, and I encourage you to do it.
Yeah.
So I think.
Yeah.
I think really that this is a new movement, and you know we need faculty who are asking those kinds of questions, who are doing acceleration experiments with the students that are in their, you know, purview that they're addressing, and then presenting about it, talking about your experiences. There's a wide open opportunity and interest in those kinds of questions. So I just encourage you to try some things and make that extra effort of representing what you're learning.
I think for ESL, is anybody ESL in the room? I think ESL, I have the same response. Yeah. It's like, how do we accelerate inside a language learning context?
Yeah.
I think that's a really open question for the field, an important question.
Yeah.
So Katie, I find that when I spend time with people who have spent a lot of time in an issue that I want to get a you have a really good feel. I'm developmental English, and you have a really good feel. You live and breathe this stuff for years now, and I know that we've seen a lot of different models. I know what your college is doing, but partly it's doing that based on the limits of what people are willing to do.
Mm-hmm, exactly.
So I just wanted to ask you if you had no limits.
Blue sky, what would you do?
Well, whatever you consider to be the
limits. Yes, if I were queen of the world.
Yeah, what would you design?
Queen of your department.
Yeah.
Certainly for the English aspect.
Oh, that's a great, God, what a lovely thing
correct
to even.
Model.
Yeah, that we would lower our cut score for 1A, our college English course. It wouldn't be 84% of students are blocked out. We might use measures like high school GPA as a better predictor of how students are going to do to sort of the structure that I would imagine is we have students who could enroll in just a straight college English class, 3 units, no extra add-on. They could enroll in a college English plus support with a couple of units that are very directly tied to the content of that class, the support with the readings of that class, and the writing assignments, not generic grammar-based. Taught by the same teacher, preferably, like the ALP model. And then there would be a one-semester option, but you could take the four-unit standalone that we currently have, or you could take it with some extra units if you're in a higher-risk group, if you've failed it before, if you're in that bottom 20% that does have lower pass rates wherever they go. Or maybe it's just directed self-placement that we might use Accuplacer to sort of flag, but then let the students know, we would let them know what the different options are and what the expectations are and what the support are, and then let them place themselves. A number of the Cal State universities have been doing that and having really good results. And one community college that I know of, Moorpark, does self-placement, including into college English. So that would be my dream of what my department would do. And we would continue to do the shared curriculum building and the culture around our philosophy and all of that rich classroom-based work to help us be successful with students.
Yeah, I think that we've finished the morning session. So please, welcome these people and let's give them a good round of applause. Thanks, Katie and Myra. We just have one announcement before I hand it over to you, Kathy.
Hi, this is just a quick announcement to those of you who are interested in participating in the Northwest Association of Developmental Educators and NWCRLA organizational meeting. My name's Laylee. You probably received an email from me. We'll be meeting at lunch over in classroom 106 right across the way, so just wanted to let you know about that.
I have one request for you is that Community College and Workforce Development has paid for this whole thing out of strategic funds, I think it is. Is that right? And so part of that, so that we can keep the Secretary of State's office and everybody else happy, would you please fill out a green thing? Because we didn't have you sign in and check off or sign that you're here today, and they need to know how many people actually showed up. That we actually did this and didn't just go outside and play or go see the Dalai Lama. So for the afternoon, I know some of you are not staying for the afternoon, and so this is sort of a do it on the, fly. So when I looked down the list, it kind of looked like about two-thirds of us were more the reading and writing folks, and about a third of us were math. We have three classrooms, and we have two presenters. So there's the math problem. So what I'm guessing that you may be doing is some presentation at the beginning, but then there may be some like split up into smaller groups, or are we staying all together? So we, yeah. Okay, so we have three classrooms, and I think we just maybe pick the one on the end and that one on the end, and we can move the furniture, and so we just may end up moving chairs to the place that we need to put them. So isn't that highly logistically? We have plenty of room in each one for, we just may have to move some furniture and then move it back. Sure, yeah. Yeah, we'll do that.
And we're starting again
at 1, yes. There, you can go into, I think either one of the courtyards if you'd like to eat outside, or back in here or into the classroom. So lunch is ready. So thank you very much.
Thank you for coming.